Welcome everyone to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee's fifth meeting of 2021. And apologies for this morning's meeting have been received from Annie Wells. And I would like to welcome Sue Webber, who's attending this morning's meeting in Annie's absence. Welcome to Sue. And our first agenda item this morning is to invite Sue Webber to declare any relevant interest to the committee. Sue.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I'm a local authority councillor with the City of Edinburgh. But my salary is donated in full via the Give As You Earn scheme directly through HR payroll, and I'm also 100% own the issues of the business Medinburgh Limited, which was a company that was involved in healthcare sales and marketing, albeit at the weekend it was deregistered on Companies House and hasn't traded since May 2021. Thank you.
Thank you. Our second item is to decide whether to take items 6, 7, 8 and 9 in private, and that's to consider evidence heard in our stakeholder sessions this morning and to consider two legislative consent memorandum. Are members agreed? We're agreed. Thank you. So now on to our third and main item today. It's a roundtable with stakeholders on public health. And this is intended to inform the committee's future work programme discussions. And we've got our panellists joining us online. I'd like to welcome Professor Sahari Burns, the Professor of Practice and Special Advisor, University of Strathclyde. Professor Sir Michael Marmot, the Professor of Epidemiology at University College London and Director of University College London Institute of Health Equity, and Professor Catherine Smith, who is Professor of Public Health Policy at Strathclyde University. Welcome to you all. I guess I'd like to kick things off and set the kind of the agenda for today, because we've called on all of you to help inform where you think the major themes lie in public health, but also where the committee perhaps might want to focus its efforts in terms of scrutiny and adding value, on top of what maybe the previous committee did, and looking at the landscape and more generally where we can actually prioritise our work programme. And your advice on that is greatly appreciated. So if I maybe come to each of our professors in turn and just ask broadly where you think the committee should be focusing its efforts in terms of scrutiny of the public health agenda, and where we might be able to add value and get your advice on that. And I'll come to Catherine Smith, Professor Smith, first.
Morning, committee. Yes, so my particular expertise is on understanding how previous policy approaches to address health inequalities have worked and what shaped those policies, and also understanding public views on health inequalities in the UK. I guess I would focus, my recommendation would be to focus scrutiny on ensuring that the policy-making processes to tackle public health problems are being properly joined up with the range of other policy areas that we know impact on public health, all of the social determinants. And that is something that the Scottish Government has recognised for a very long time, that it's things like housing and wealth and jobs that shape people's health. But it seems to have been really difficult to join policy making up so that we're thinking about those links adequately, so how policy decisions in other areas are impacting on public health and vice versa. I know there have been efforts recently with public health reforms in Scotland, but I think I'd be keeping a really close eye on that, because every time that doesn't work out well, we end up with a kind of what we call in public health a downstream drift, where even though policymakers know that things that they're doing aren't the most effective things, they end up doing that because that's what they've got control over, those policy levers. That'd be my main recommendation.
Thank you. Can I just move just up a shout out to broadcasting that Professor Smith's feed is really quite jumpy, and I'm wondering whether or not if we maybe take the video off, that the sound, the most important part, we were able to hear some of that, but it was quite jumpy. But thank you. Maybe get that sorted out. And can I come to Professor Marmot?
May I tell you a story about a mythical country that, for purposes of this morning, I'll call Norway? The Some years ago, the Minister of Foreign Affairs said, I am a health minister because what I do in my day job influences health. And he said, every minister is a health minister because what we do in our day job influences health. And then I had a phone call from an official that I knew well in the Ministry of Health in Norway. And she said, you know, you've been going around the world saying that our Minister of Foreign Affairs says he's a health minister. He now is our health minister and he'd like to meet you. Well, so I met him. I went to Norway to meet him. He now is or will be the Prime Minister. Jonas Støre, I'm not saying that correctly, but the message, which I presume he will take to the Prime Minister's office, is that what happens across the whole of government is key for public health and particularly for health inequalities. Yes, the healthcare system is important. Yes, organized public health is important, but it's what happens across the whole of government. And indeed, in my Build Back Fairer report for England that I published in December 2020 and for Greater Manchester that I published in June 2021, I said that we need to put equity of health and well-being at the heart of all government policy. So in other words, it's a whole approach to health equity, to reducing health inequalities. It says it should be at the heart of all government policy. And there's discussion going on at this very moment about energy prices because of shortage of gas. I've heard very little from government ministers about the likely distributional impact of the prices. That will have a huge impact on health inequalities. If poor people have to pay more for their heating and we have a cold winter, that's going to have an immediate impact on health inequalities. So putting equity of health and well-being at the heart of all government policy is key to the public health and to reducing health inequalities.
Thank you. And can I come to Professor Burns?
Well, I'm very much in the same sort of theme as Sir Michael. Health, when we talk about health, we tend to think about illness. You know, absence of health is being ill. In fact, for many years I was a surgeon and I gave up surgery because I wanted to understand how we created wellness as opposed to tackling illness. And Sir Michael's absolutely right. It's a very broad agenda. It's what we would call a complex adaptive system creating well-being. And the problem with policy is that politicians like to do a thing. There is a policy on fatty foods, there's a policy on smoking, there's a policy on alcohol and so on. In fact, we create well-being through a whole range of different things which are not typically achieved through top-down policy. You can facilitate creation of well-being by policy, but in fact, well-being to a very large extent is created in the relationships that people have with each other. An example. So I speak a lot about the way in which well-being is created through early life. It's created in the way children are born and raised and so on. And creating an environment that allows these children to feel safe, to feel happy, to feel as if they have an opportunity to do well in life is really the thing that I would want my government to be doing, to be supporting. To give you an example, one person, but I could, you know, I've had this kind of conversation with many, many people. A guy who is currently working in a good job, started off life in prison. Well, started off his adult life in prison. And when I spoke to him about his experiences, he said, well, my mum and dad fought like cat and dog, and I would always get the blame for the fighting. It was always me that was in trouble. Then when I went to school, if there was any trouble in school, I got the blame for it. And then when I was out in the streets with my mates, if there was anything that happened at all, I would get the blame for it. Eventually, I ended up in jail. And the thing that transformed his life was a prison officer who took the time to come in and talk to him every day and tell him he was better than that, that he was a clever guy, that he could do things in life, that he could... And building that trusting relationship with someone allowed this guy to begin to value himself. And when he came out, he now has a full-time job, paying taxes, living well, family, children, but he goes and he helps other people who are in that position. And in order to, and I would like to see a society where the politicians help support a bottom-up approach to improving well-being. Ask frontline staff, go out and find out what people need, rather than telling them what they're going to get, is a really important thing. Politicians love a policy that they can, fly a flag for, but in fact, it's building relationships that support people living in difficult circumstances that I think we need to be doing. And there's lots of examples of organisations that are currently doing that, and we need to be supporting them.
Thank you. That's very helpful for starting to think about, I guess, where our focuses might be. And certainly one of the themes that we want to ask you about is around the things about life expectancy and some of the factors in there. And obviously, a few of you in front of us today have been involved in very important reporting on that, which... We've all read many reports on, and it's a hugely complex area. I'd like to move on to my colleagues, have some questions around the kind of issues about life expectancy. And I'm going to start with questions from Evelyn Tweed. Evelyn.
My questions are around the kind of moniker that we've had as the sick man of Europe. In your opinion, is that still a moniker that applies to Scotland?
And who would you like to address that first to, Evelyn?
Sir Harry, please.
It's not a term that I have ever recognised or supported. There is no question that there are that inequalities began to widen dramatically in Scotland around about the 1950s, and that was the time when industry was collapsing and housing policy shifted to creating new towns where folk did not feel they belonged and so on. We can point to social drivers that created widening inequality and life expectancy. But no, I don't... It's unhelpful to label us in those terms, because if we're told that, then folk just shrug their shoulders and say, well, that's it, I'm going out for another beer and to hell with it, you know. And those are the kind of conversations I used to have with my patients. Oh, well, life is not worth living, so the booze is the only pleasure I've got in life, so I'm just going to keep drinking. I heard that statement many times. So, no, I don't think we can... label ourselves that way. We can be doing a lot better, and we should begin to take action to make these things better. But that action is complex and not straightforward. It's not as straightforward as banning smoking in public places was a great step forward. It was important. Minimum pricing of alcohol made a difference. But we need to get in and help people feel more in control of their lives and take positive decisions about their health. That's what we should be focusing on. Thanks.
Would any of our other panellists like to come in. Maybe if I can, I can go to Professor Marmot on that.
If I may, I'm sorry, I didn't hear the question very well. I heard Harry very clearly, but if I understood, so I'm guessing at the question from Harry's response, so tell me if I'm wrong. It's quite, we've been doing a lot of work in England, and I'm quite keen to work with Scottish colleagues, I have to say, but we've been doing work in different parts of England. And let me give you some statistics for the moment. And I think Scotland is like England, only more so in this respect. If you look at life expectancy by level of deprivation of the area in which people live, it's a gradient. The least deprived have the longest life expectancy, the most deprived, the shortest, and it's a gradient. And what we see is if we look at regional differences in England, then for the least deprived, the regional differences are tiny. If you're rich, it doesn't much matter where you live. And I'm guessing that that applies to Scotland as well. If you're rich, it doesn't much matter where you live. The more deprived the area in which you live, the bigger the disadvantage of living in the northeast or the northwest compared to London. And in fact, over the decade from 2010, life expectancy for the poorest 10% improved in London and went down in every other region of England. Wow. Things got worse for the poor in terms of health. Their health declined. Now, if you look at the northeast and the northwest, you could say, a bit like Harry just described from deindustrialization in Scotland, you could say it's hopeless. Growing up north of Tyne, growing up in Cheshire and Merseyside, in parts of Greater Manchester, it's hopeless. The future looks grim. That is not the approach that people in those regions are taking. We've been invited into each of the places I've just mentioned, Cheshire and Merseyside. Yesterday, we launched a commission in Cumbria and in Lancashire and South Cumbria. We did a report for Greater Manchester. We've been approached by North of Tyne. And the approach they're taking is, this is not hopeless. We can improve the quality of lives of people who live in these regions. It has to be a partnership. We have to work together. But we don't start from the assumption that this is all hopeless. It's pretty grim to know that for poor people, their health got worse over the last decade. That's quite an indictment of public policy. But the starting position is we can improve things. We can really make a difference. And it seems to me that's absolutely right. I mean, launching this commission literally yesterday, last evening, in Lancashire and South Cumbria, deprived area of the country, huge inequalities within the region, the starting position from local government, from the voluntary and community sector, from business, from regional government is we can make a real difference. We can work with our population to improve the quality of lives and improve health. And I would say that has to be the starting position in every region of Scotland.
And can I come to Professor Smith?
Yes, is the feed working better now?
Yes, that's a lot better.
Okay, great. Yes, so I agree with a lot of what's been said. I think, I mean, there's different ways of thinking about Scotland's relative performance with health and health inequalities, but I think it's much better to think there's lots of examples around about Scotland where we can look to for some inspiration, where things are going a bit better, and we can look to see what they've done. So I would try and frame it that way around. I agree thinking about Scotland as a stick man of Europe is not particularly helpful framing. Nonetheless, I think we do need to recognise there are some issues that seem to be particularly bad in Scotland. Drugs-related deaths and alcohol-related deaths are particular issues that I think Scotland needs to have a focus on. I also, just to support what my colleagues have just articulated, I think a key issue is thinking about how we have a public conversation around health inequalities and how we have that kind of bottom-up approach. And I think, you know, even beyond the voluntary sector and the frontline services, we need to be having a conversation with members of the public about health inequalities and how to tackle them. That's something that's been quite lacking in research on health inequalities. I'm one of the few people I know who's tried to do research on what members of the public think about health inequalities in the UK and in Scotland. And that research suggests they're really quite concerned about health inequalities, very supportive of a lot of policy proposals to tackle social determinants of health in health inequalities. And I think, again, that should give us lots of reasons to be hopeful in this area. Thank you.
Thank you. And can I come to Gillian Mackay?
Do the panel feel that we need specific interventions in specific places or more system-wide interventions? For example, air pollution kills 2,500 Scots per year, according to Friends of the Earth Scotland. In my region, we have Scotland's biggest polluter, and in our papers in particular, there's a focus on Glasgow. And for me, I think Glasgow's a relatively unique example in Scotland in the fact it's one of our major cities, but it also has a very large motorway running through the middle of it, and there are obviously particular issues in Glasgow with early deaths and things. So does the panel think that we need to make specific place-based interventions, or whether there is a wider system change on air pollution and other determinants of poor health that we need to make?
And Maria, we'll come to Professor Burns first on that.
Yep.
There's no question that if you pick up on things, if we measure things like air pollution, not just outside, but in homes and in schools and so on, these things have become much more important with the advent of COVID, where we've been interested in ventilation and so on. Yeah, these are things that can help. Come back to the point that the major drivers of inequalities in life expectancy in Scotland are not things like heart attacks and cancers. They are a wide differential in deaths amongst young working age people due to drugs, alcohol, suicide, violence and accidents. So yes, we can look at individual issues, and we should do, and things like air pollution are an important aspect of this, but you know, we must, if we're going to achieve success, we're going to have to help support young people who get themselves into difficulties, because they're the ones who will die young because of those difficulties that they get into with drugs and alcohol and so on. There was a study done in the University of Glasgow some years ago that showed that heart attack deaths were relatively small contributors to health inequalities. The difference in death rates from drugs, alcohol, suicide and violence begin to shoot up in the teenage years. So I'm really keen that the Parliament should focus on the creation of well-being in families and support for families in early life. And all the other things are important, but if we don't do the early life stuff, the other things are just going to have a relatively minor impact. Thanks.
Thank you. And Professor Marmot would like to come in.
Yeah, if I could make three points. The first is, I talk to a lot of different disease-specific groups. So I was asked to talk to dentists about oral health. I showed them two graphs with the social gradient by deprivation. So classify people by where they live, classify where they live by degree of deprivation, divide it into deciles, 10%, and you see a gradient. And I didn't put labels on the y-axis, so I didn't say which diseases I was looking at. But there was an identical gradient. And one of them, when I did put the labels on, one was COVID-19 mortality, and the other was decayed, missing, and filled teeth in children. Identical gradient. And then I was giving a talk to some heart disease people, so I got a third graph, and I didn't label that one either. That was childhood obesity. Identical gradient. So we could focus on cardiovascular disease, we could focus on oral health, we can focus on COVID-19. COVID-19 is caused by a virus. Dental caries is caused by diet and poor oral hygiene. Childhood obesity is caused by, well, you know, your guess is as good as mine. And they show identical social gradients. So we could have, and I could show you air pollution in schools in London. Identical gradient. The poorer the area, the higher the degree of air pollution in schools in London. Identical gradient. And I'm very happy for the heart disease people to focus on childhood obesity. And I'm very happy for the oral health people to focus on reducing dental caries, and infectious disease people to focus on COVID-19. But we have to deal with inequalities which are underlying each of these specific conditions. Now, that's the first thing to say. And it's not either or. I recently reviewed Jeremy Farrar's book on spike on COVID-19, Jeremy Farrar being the director of the Wellcome Trust and a member of SAGE. I think he mentioned inequalities once in the book. And I didn't pan the book because of that. It was a brilliant book. I enjoyed reading it. I learned a lot. I gave it a very positive review. I did comment, my approach is to deal with the inequalities. His approach is to deal with control of the virus. It's not either or, it's both. We need both of those. The second point, do we focus on particularly high-risk areas, or do we need something more general? And in my 2010 English review, I coined the rather awkward phrase, proportionate universalism. And I, classic British compromise, I was trying to deal with the classic Anglo-Saxon approach to social policy, which is to target the worst off, and a more Nordic approach, which is universalist policies. And when Harry Burns was Chief Medical Officer of Scotland, he said, I'm all for Nordic universalist approaches. So I was trying to bring the two together, because when you accept there's a gradient, if you focus only on the worst off, you miss most of the inequalities, which are not confined to the very worst off. But we need effort proportionate to need. Excuse me. Hence, proportionate universalism. And I think that's absolutely right. So we need to improve air quality for everybody, and we need to work harder, to take your example, and we need to work harder in the most polluted areas. And the third thing that I wanted to say, particularly in relation to air pollution, but it illustrates the more general point, which is we need to make common cause between dealing with health inequalities and dealing with the climate crisis. And in Glasgow, of all places in 2021, it's the right time and place to be thinking about that. And the big advantage of air pollution in this context is we do make common cause. If we can do something about greenhouse gas emissions and achieving net zero greenhouse gas emissions, we will reduce air pollution. and we will improve health as a result. Been making common cause with dealing with the climate crisis and reduction of health inequalities is of crucial importance.
Thank you. And I'm just checking if Professor Smith would like to come in. I'm going in the assumption that if our panellists put an R in the chat box that they want to come in, because my clerks are just feeding that back to me. But I'll just check ahead of moving on to questions from Sue Webber. Does Professor Smith want to add anything?
Very quickly, I'll just add, so I agree with a lot of what's been said. I think if you think about an issue like air pollution, you have to take a systemic approach to that, because many of the things that impact on that are systems-wide issues, like the transport infrastructure, where particular factories are located and things like that. I totally agree that we, and I very much like Professor Michael Marmot's concept of proportionate universalism. I think it's a really useful concept. If we focus just on places, which is sometimes what happens in efforts to address health inequalities, I think what we lose is that kind of wider national level outlook, and we end up zoning down on policy levers that sit at that local level, and they're often insufficient. We also kind of lose a focus on that wider issue of national level health inequalities, and we end up focusing on small level improvements in those particular areas. It is important to do those small level improvements that local areas can offer, but it's really important that we combine that with national level thinking, that kind of systemic cross-cutting planning that means that when we're making decisions that impact climate change, as Professor Michael Marmot said, we're also thinking about how they impact on health and that those decisions are linked up. So what I would really encourage the committee to do is focus on what the Scottish Government is doing to try and make links across those different policy areas.
Thank you. And questions on this issue from Sue Webber.
No, thank you very much. There's obviously a lot of synergy in what we're hearing in terms of it being about tackling the health inequalities. And I was really interested in what Professor Burns stated there early doors about how right now we're looking at our policy all focuses on that top-down approach, but we really need to focus on that bottom-up if we're going to capture and really help the young people that are having those early deaths when they're in difficulties through suicide, violence, drug and alcohol. But I suppose my question is, if we were to... We only have a finite set of resources. That's the world we live in, and we know that we want to focus and determine on that bottom-up approach. What do we do with that top-down approach? We can't be everywhere, because right now our resources are on tackling waiting lists, hip, knee replacements, etc., are all of the older generation, whereas you're saying we need to be really focusing in on catching and supporting the young. So how do we square that off with the public, I suppose? Or how best do you think we might want to do that?
Right, who would like to go first on that? If I come to Professor Burns first, because the microphone has been switched off.
Okay. So if I can give you an example, I mean, I guess your sound broke up a wee bit there, but I mean, I think what you're asking is, how do you square off what politicians in Parliament can do with the bottom-up approach? And I think, for me, the most important thing is give permission to the front line to begin to do stuff. And I'll give you an example. I was speaking to a group of district nurses in a deprived part of Scotland, very significantly deprived part of Scotland. And they were telling me that when they got together in the office over cups of tea, they shared stories about families and so on, and they thought, well, look, we know about 30 families here who are really, really struggling. I wonder how often they go to the A&E department of the local hospital. So they got the names together and they asked the local hospital, and they found that members of these families were going to the local A&E department about once or twice a week. And then one of them happened to be talking to the local community police officer, and he said, oh, I know who those are. And he went away and found out how often those members of those families were dialing 999. And again, it was a very high number. And What I take about out of stories of these, and I hear these kind of stories all over the place, is that if we were to bring together the different parts of the system and ask the frontline staff there, okay, who are struggling and how do we reach out to them? I mean, I've never done this because it's difficult to get the data, but if you asked the local education department about the children in those families, I bet you those children are probably only attending school 50% of the time. So it's a whole system problem. And the most important thing, I think, is for Parliament to give permission to the front line to begin to reach out to those individuals, ask them, what do you need? How can we help you? How can we support you in improving control over your lives? We know from a whole range of studies that have been done that that's the most important thing. Hopelessness and helplessness in these families cause them to be struggling. If we give them some hope and some feeling that they can be in control of their lives, then you will find a lot of these things turning about. So create an environment that allows individuals to be helped by frontline staff. Allow frontline staff to come up. I mean, I've just finished a year as president of the British Medical Association, and I don't get involved in the politics of the BMA, but they support me in doing a project. And for my project, I asked all the GPs in Britain to send in stories as to how they helped struggling families. And we're pulling these together, and we're going to have a conference about it next month. But it's these stories of how you reach out to an individual and how you can change that individual's life that we need to pull together, and we need to share the stories, and we begin to build a programme of support for families who are struggling. Thanks.
Can I have a quick follow-up on that, just specifically on something he stated, Commissioner? Professor Burns, you spoke about the data and how difficult it is to get the data, and it sounds like in that one example, you had members of frontline staff that were out and did a lot of initiative in digging around themselves. So how important would it be that we had systems that spoke and talked to each other in terms of that data sharing?
Yeah, that is very important. I mean, I've struggled. I have a research assistant who has been trying for a long time to pull data together to allow us to begin to identify people who need help. I think I'm making progress with the Scottish Government on this. All that data, effectively under General Data Protection Regulations, rests with the Scottish Government. And if we can pull it together, and let's say we took an area out of Scotland and we saw, okay, there are, you know, 500 people in this area who the data tells us are in difficulty. Let's begin to support them in different ways and follow it. And then a year later, we find that that 500 has fallen to 100. Then we know that we're making progress. And there are examples. The city of Stoke-on-Trent a few years ago did something like this. They calculated how much the public sector was spending on these individuals who were struggling. It was about £100,000 a year, they found. Once they implemented this kind of bottom-up support, that fell to about £400 a year, £400-£500 a year. And, you know, those are very, very soft figures, but it shows that the public sector can do things differently and save a lot of time and effort in the process. Thanks.
Professor Marmot wanted to come in on this.
Such an important question about top-down, bottom-up. It's such an important question. In my own research, I put a lot of emphasis on control at work, how much control individuals have, and being in situations without control increases risk of physical illness and mental illness. And indeed, when I chaired the WHO Commission on social determinants of health. We privileged empowerment, which we thought of as acting at an individual level, but also at a community level and indeed at a national level. And then recently, the Commission on Racial and Ethnic Disparities, in its much maligned report, including by me, I maligned it, said, no, there's no racism in Britain. There's no structural racism. We think that individuals and communities should be empowered. They should take control of their own lives. And that gave me real pause. I thought, have I got this wrong? If a group that says there's no racism and there's no structural causes of inequality says it's up to individuals and communities to act for themselves, I thought, maybe I've got it all wrong. What I've been saying for decades is completely wrong. I don't think that allowing people to take control of their lives means that the state should have no role. I'd written about poor parts of Glasgow based on case histories given to me by John Carnahan, who was a detective superintendent in charge of homicide. And he talked about a typical individual growing up in Calton, in Glasgow, who had a single mother. They moved home every 18 months. Mother had a succession of partners, each of whom abused this young fellow. By the time the boy went to school, he'd already been labelled as a behaviour problem. As soon as he was old enough, he was involved in gangs, labelled juvenile delinquent, never had a proper job. He drank and smoked, did drugs, thrown out by girlfriends because of violent behaviour. And now we're going to come along and say, yeah, take control of your life. Yeah, look after you, pull your socks up, stop drinking, eat properly, get a job, stop abusing your girlfriend, look after yourself. We're going to let you take control. But that's a parody. It's a grotesque caricature. We need to create the conditions for people to take control of their lives. If that young person that had a stable background, had a decent education, and then chose to do whatever he did, that's up to him. But without creating the conditions for people to take control of their lives, then we're not doing our job properly. So in other words, my response to the question about top-down or community involvement is yes, we need top-down and we need community involvement. Ultimately, people should be able to take control of their lives, but we need to address the social determinants of health and health equity that allow them, that give them the capabilities to take control of their life.
And Professor Burns wanted to come back in.
Professor Marmot was saying there, this business about people make decisions, and some people make good decisions, and some people make bad decisions, some people are in control, some people are not. There is a strong scientific body of evidence that shows that children who experience chaotic early life are less well able to make those decisions. Studies, first of all, done in America, showed that centers of the brain in children who experienced adversity in early life that control emotions and control decision-making and control learning are abnormally developed. And we did some studies in Glasgow that showed exactly the same thing. People at the lower end of the social scale had structural abnormalities in the brain that, and functional, those structural abnormalities, we measured function as well, And these individuals were more emotionally arousable, more anxious, aggressive, fearful, less well able to make decisions when faced with difficult choices, and also less well able to learn at school. So that's what happens when you have chaotic and difficult early life. Bruce McEwen, the scientist, the neuroscientist in New York who showed this, regrettably Bruce died last year, but before he died, he told me that he had done a study that showed that those changes could be reversed in later life. And an important part of the process of change of repairing and restoring those problems was mentoring, the support of a trusted other person to help that individual begin to feel in control of their lives. So it's a very complex system. And he's right, we need top-down support to allow the front line to engage and help these individuals in an appropriate way. And we need very much the ability to pull the data together that demonstrates that we're making change happen. Thanks.
Thank you. And can I come to Professor Smith?
Thanks. I'll turn my video off in case it helps. I wanted to come back to the original point of if we've got limited resources, how do we decide what to focus on? And I completely agree with what Sir Harry said in terms of you've got to think about systems and how systems, the different bits of the systems interact. We can do that at a local level, like Sir Harry was describing. We can also do that at national level in terms of how we make national level policy decisions. I'm involved in one project that's trying to support the Scottish Government to do that at the moment. There will be others. The project I'm involved in is funded by the UK PRP and it's called Cypher, and it's trying to implement systems decision support tools based on systems modelling rather than the kind of more silo based modelling that we've tend to have. So it's trying to look at if you do one thing in the system, one policy decision in the system, how does that impact on the other areas of the system at national level? And I think you do need that national level systems thinking as well as the local level systems thinking. But for that kind of modelling and systems thinking to work, we of course do need good data. And so I'm also agreeing with what Sir Harry is saying there. And a key area that I think the COVID pandemic has highlighted that Scotland isn't doing particularly well on is data around ethnicity. That's really problematic in Scotland, and it would be really good to ensure that more effort is put on ensuring that we have the right data. If you're not even capturing the data that you need, then you can't feed it into that kind of evidence-informed decision-making and modelling and so on. And then the third thing I'd say is, so I think it's really important to bring the public with you. Of course it is in a democracy, but for me that doesn't mean only doing things at a grassroots level. I think we also need to be thinking about what are the mechanisms we have in Scotland for bringing the public into conversations about macro level policy decisions. How are we having those public conversations? Where are they taking place? I think it really struck me that when I've done research for over many years looking at how policymakers and researchers have tried to tackle the issue of health inequalities. And in the course of that research, many of them told me that members of the public don't support the kinds of evidence-informed policy proposals that researchers put forward. When I explored that via a national survey and citizens' juries, that did not appear to be the case. In fact, members of the public seem to understand the social determinants of health very well, and particularly if they'd experienced deprivation, as we might expect. And they were also very supportive of policy decisions that were trying to address those social determinants of health, things like housing. And they gave very clear and persuasive accounts of how changing something like housing has a knock-on impact on so many different aspects of your health and well-being. So, yeah, I think it's really important to think about how we have those public conversations and also research that's trying to better understand what the public actually think about issues like health inequalities and potential policy interventions. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to questions from Emma Harper. Emma.
Thanks, convener. Good morning to our panel of experts. The Scottish Government have published public health priorities with a number of items that need to be addressed, like we need a Scotland where we flourish in our early years, We need a Scotland where we have good mental well-being. We need to reduce the use of and harm from alcohol, tobacco and other drugs. There's six priorities listed, and this is the first time that Scotland has had a simple overarching public health strategy, and it's the first time that the national public health priorities are aimed at wider determinants of health. You know, and for me, I'm now the co-convener of the Health Inequality Cross-Party Group and the Improvement Scotland's Health Cross-Party Group and the Diabetes Cross-Party Group. And I'm trying to bring them all together so that we can have everybody around the table having the same conversation instead of conversations in, like, silos, for instance. But I'm interested to hear from the expert panel whether they agree with the Scottish Government's public health priorities, or do you feel there's something that needs to be added?
Okay, let's go to Professor Marmot, first of all.
Thank you. From what you've just said, I think it's a pretty good list. In my English review, I had six domains of recommendations to reduce health inequalities. Interestingly, a Swedish commission picked up my six, and which I'll tell you just now, and added a seventh, which I'll also tell you, but I would think they apply well in Scotland. So the six were, first, early child development, give every child the best start in life, equity from the start, exactly what Harry's been talking about and what you've just said. The second was education and lifelong learning. The third was employment and working conditions. And in that, important is the transition from school to work, reducing the proportion of young people not in employment, education or training. The fourth, which is a hot issue this very week in England, with the about to take £1,000 a year off universal credit. The fourth is everyone should have at least the minimum income necessary for a healthy life. It took a young footballer to get the government to do a U-turn on free school meals for people who couldn't afford to feed their children. Somehow it took a young footballer to shame the government into saying it was really not very good if poor kids went to bed hungry. The fifth, and it relates to the earlier discussion about pollution, the fifth is healthy and sustainable places in which to live and work. That includes housing, but environments, transport, and that very much relates to the climate issue. And the sixth is taking a social determinants approach to prevention. So Harry talked, for example, about drugs and alcohol, and we could add in smoking, diet, exercise, not simply telling people to eat well or behave properly, but dealing with the social conditions that relate to behaviours. So those six, and the seventh one that the Swedes added to their commission, was people having control over their life. Yes, of course, that underpins the others. So those would be my priorities. And if you ask me what I would recommend for Scotland, I would recommend those same priorities.
Thank you.
And I'll come to our other panellists. If we can come to Professor Smith.
Thank you. I'm very supportive of Scotland's public health priorities. I think they're a great list of priority areas. I feel that tackling inequalities in wealth and poverty isn't as clearly highlighted in the list as it could be and as it should be for Scotland. But beyond that, I think it's a really good set of kind of goals that Scotland's aiming for. I think the issue is very much how to achieve them. So how we create the policy decisions that are going to achieve those policy priorities and goals and make them realistic. I think that is where we need the systems thinking, because there are a very wide list that cut across a huge range of policy areas. So you need policy tools that are going to help you think about where do you get the win-wins and the best returns on your investment in that system. So that would be a key thing that I'd say. And I think the other issue is thinking about how policy making in the Scottish Government interacts with the wider political system. Because it's great to see the Scottish Government trying to join up their policy making around public health, and I know the public health reforms have all been centred on that. But when policy making interacts with that wider political system, that kind of lobbying and advocacy that goes on, where different organisations are for very good reasons trying to influence policy, that often pulls things back to the silo-based nature of policy making. So we need to think about how Scotland can maintain that focus on joining things up and not get pulled into focusing on one specific issue, because there's lots of advocacy and lobbying, lots of media attention going on around that. And because, as Sir Harry said, it can be very attractive politically to feel like you're fixing one very clear thing and you can see what you're doing in that issue. So we need to, I think, really get on board with this public health reform agenda, but maintain that cross-cutting sense and implement, really go with that systems thinking and thinking where you can get your best buys. Thank you.
Thank you. Professor Burns.
Both Michael and Kat on what they've been saying, we have to get in behind it, but the question is, how do we do it? How do we deliver it? And in fact, Scotland has a good track record on this. When we did the Patient Safety Collaborative, 10 years ago now, we reduced surgical mortality, we reduced standardised mortality rates in hospitals significantly, and internationally that was hailed as being a world leader, the way in which we'd done it. We did it by asking frontline staff to come up with ideas. The Early Years Collaborative, tell you a story about one thing there. It was decided that one of the things that we needed to do was to make sure that 90% of all children reached all the developmental milestones by the 30-month health visitor assessment. When we started doing it, we discovered, to our horror, that only 60% of Scottish children actually got a 30-month health visitor assessment. And all sorts of heads were being scratched, and one health visitor in one clinic and one health board authority thought, I wonder if the parents aren't turning up because we send the appointments out in brown envelopes. Brown envelopes not being very popular in houses in deprived areas. So what she did was she started texting the time of the appointments to families. And before we knew it, she was getting 90% of all children being brought for the assessment. So she told all the other nurses in that clinic, she told all the other nurses in that health board, and eventually 90% across Scotland were coming for the assessment. That shows you how one frontline staff member can have a clever idea and a clever insight, and if we spread the learning, we get significant change and improvement. And before we started the Early Years Collaborative, Scotland had the highest infant mortality of the four UK countries. Now we have the lowest infant mortality of the four UK countries. So big change can take place, but sitting in Holyrood and sitting in academic departments and so on, we can say, well, yes, this is how we might do it, but actually doing it requires the involvement and the involvement of frontline staff to help shape and deliver it. So, yes, let's go full pelt with that list of priorities, but let's create a collaborative approach to making it happen. Thank you.
Thank you. Emma, you wanted to come back in.
Sure, I will be quick. Basically, I'm thinking about low-hanging fruit, and I know that healthcare providers are starting to get more education about adverse childhood experiences, and South Ayrshire Police are now going through a training to recognise ACEs, so that's really important. But when I started my vaccination programme training, the e-learning modules, there was nothing about tackling stigma related to alcohol and drugs for healthcare professionals who work outside alcohol and drug services. So if we're thinking about low-hanging fruit and on-the-ground delivery of education, would you think that we need to be looking at making sure healthcare professionals know about adverse childhood experiences as well as things like stigma related to alcohol and drugs?
And that's directed at?
That could be for Professor Harry Burns.
You're absolutely right. We need to be aware, and I've been working with Police Scotland, I've been working with Ayrshire Councils and so on, I've been working with a number of councils to get them to realise this, and some of them are taking this on board very well. I think a systematic training around adverse experiences would be important. Just while I'm talking about adverse experiences, a lot of our learning from that comes from a big study that was carried out in California many years ago, and it showed very clearly the link between the number of adverse experiences and the poor health and well-being outcomes that you get. But the interesting thing about that clinic, the Adverse Childhood Experiences Clinic, it started off life as a weight reduction clinic. The clinicians wanted to reduce the weight in people, and they found lots of folk in which they couldn't get the weight down. And by chance, one of them discovered that the patients that he was dealing with had had abuse and neglect as children, and they switched it to an ACEs clinic. So that shows you just how complex a problem like obesity is. And, you know, when I hear ministers stand up and say they want to ban advertising of high-calorie foods on television, I think, aye, that'll be right. You'll get a good result out of that. It's much more complex and much more basic, the whole problem. So, yep, you're right. ACEs, awareness and collecting the data and identifying the people who need help and support and not stigmatising them, you know, They are as they are because of the situation in which they've been, and helping them to take more control of their lives is going to be the way ahead. Thanks.
So there's a couple of other members want to come in the policy priorities, but before, I believe that Professor Marmot would like to come in the specific issue.
Yes, thank you. I've been to three meetings in Edinburgh about early childhood. The third one was specifically about ACEs, adverse childhood experiences. I was very impressed at the level of focus on this issue in Scotland. And at the coffee break, there was a group of students from Edinburgh University, public health students, who were buzzing around about me and filling my ear with, yes, it's all very well for practitioners to be concerned with ACEs, but what about the economic and social drivers of adverse childhood experiences? It's exactly what Catherine said earlier. We can't just get practitioners to focus on ACEs and ignore the social and economic inequalities that are giving rise to ACEs. We know, the data are clear. ACEs follow the social gradient. You look at 9 specific adverse childhood experiences, and they all increase in frequency with deprivation. The greater the deprivation, the greater the frequency of ACEs. So it's great that practitioners are aware of the issue, they're focusing on it, but it illustrates absolutely clearly Catherine's point, which is the importance of putting this in the context of addressing social and economic inequalities.
Thank you. And I have a question from Stephanie Callaghan. Stephanie, you don't have to press your microphone. It's done for you.
Thank you. You've actually answered a lot of the questions that I had already, and I'm really interested as well. You know, ACEs is often something that's kind of on the edges of lots of other things that we're talking about there as well. And I'm wondering, I feel myself that that Resilience, the film, should be shown everywhere. Everybody in the public sector should be having a watch at that there to really understand how that toxic stress changes the brain and how that impacts people in later life as well and affects their health and their wellbeing all the way through. And I'm wondering as well if there's a case for a real specific focus on ACEs and whether it's something actually we should possibly be working with young people on, that we should be talking about in schools, that we should be considering what kind of impacts or whether ACEs are there in their own backgrounds. And I know as well that a lot of people who work in, for example, public health, social work, actually quite often there are positives there because a lot of these people have suffered quite a lot of ACEs in their lives, although clearly you have all the kind of negative impacts from ACEs as well there. So not about it being, writing down a list and going, you guys are going to have problems in your life because these kind of things have happened to you, but actually sitting down and being able to look at it and understand. And again, it's about that sense of control and wellbeing and understanding and appreciation. Thanks.
And have you got anyone you want to direct that to in particular, or will I just go around everyone?
No, that's fine to go generally.
Yeah.
If I
go to Professor Marmot first, and then I'll go around it, our other two panellists.
I was struck, forgive me going afield, but I was interested on visits to Australia with the health of Indigenous Australians, and the default position of the care services in Australia is not whether to take a child into care because of adverse childhood experiences, but when. So the default position is Aboriginal parents are incompetent. There's drug and alcohol abuse, domestic violence. Children need to be taken into care. And pretty well everybody one speaks to agrees that taking an Aboriginal child into care has disastrous consequences. And it costs about $100,000 a year. And my question was, for $100,000 a year, couldn't you work with the families? Couldn't you actually work with the families to try and do something about the problems of drugs and alcohol and domestic violence? And one, there's a group, this was in Victoria, of community-controlled healthcare organisations. So these are controlled by Indigenous Australians, they're community-controlled. And in one rural district, they said to me, we're doing it. We've taken formal responsibility and we use the money to work with families to deal with the problems of drugs and alcohol and domestic violence. Our default position is let's keep the families together, but to deal with the problems. And indeed, I never make the economic case for doing the right thing. I think we should do the right thing because it's the right thing to do. But they're making the economic case in addition that dealing with these problems at their source of adverse childhood experiences is actually quite cost efficient because there's such problems down the line if you don't deal with it that it's worth spending the money up front. And it's a bit like I was saying earlier that it's about top-down or community-controlled. It's both. We need to be dealing with the structural drivers, but we need to have community engagement and professional engagement in dealing with the problems of ACEs where they occur in families and communities.
Okay, I'll come to Professor Burns.
I'm reluctant to label families. I'm reluctant to say, the problem is all due to ACEs. I think this is part of the problem that we've had. We've tended to focus on a thing and try and do something about that thing. And there is a great risk, I think. You might find a family where the parents are very loving and very keen to do the best for the children, but they just don't have any money. They just don't have any kind of resource to fall back on. And the issue therefore becomes support for families, but don't go in and support families because they are bad families. You know, telling people who are struggling that they're bad and that you may have to take their children away and so on, it's just going to make them feel even more hopeless. So this is a classic example of where you need the front line to go in. If, you know, my conversations with Police Scotland, for example, have shown them to be really, really understanding about this. They see the consequences of chaotic families. And the policemen I've spoken to say, we don't want to disrupt those families, we want to help them. So if we, I think what we need from Parliament is a positive message that building relationships, building trusting relationships with families that are struggling works. And a couple of years ago, I was at the National Rural Health Conference in Australia, and exactly what Michael says was happening. People were going out. I mean, there was a really interesting presentation about homelessness from two guys who spoke to homeless folk. And one of the things that the homeless people were really anxious about was the fact that their clothes were dirty. These guys got a van, they put a washing machine and a tumble dryer in the van, and what they did was they drove around the city to places where they knew homeless folk were congregating, and they washed their clothes for them. You know, solutions emerge in unexpected ways, and that system has now spread to many cities in Australia. Ask people what they need and help them achieve it, and they begin to take control of their lives. So although I talk a lot about ACEs, I do not want people labelled by it, and I don't want a national ACEs programme. I want a let's help people who are struggling programme.
Thank you. And Professor Smith wants to come in on this, and then we'll move on to talk about COVID-19. Professor Smith.
Thanks very much. Yes, so I agree very much with the importance of having an early years focus, and I think the research literature on the importance of that is very strong and goes back decades, you know, right back to the Black Report and before. So it's very clear that if we want to tackle health inequalities and inequalities generally at a societal level, we need to be thinking about early years. But for many of the reasons that Sir Harry has said, I share some concerns about a focus on ACEs when it's kind of explicitly labelled in that way. The first is that it merges lots of different kinds of issues under that label that sometimes need to be unpicked a bit. The second is that it becomes a label in itself, which is exactly what Sir Harry was just warning about, and that label is potentially quite stigmatising. And the third is that, so some of the literature around ACEs, there was a recent review by David Walsh and colleagues, David Walsh is at the Glasgow Centre for Population Health, of the ACEs literature, and it found that only a tiny portion of that was exploring the socioeconomic context to ACEs. And I think if you're not making those links, then you're really missing a huge amount of the picture there. So it's important that if we have a focus on ACEs, it's in the context of a wider conversation, and that it in itself doesn't become a stigmatizing tool that makes conversations difficult and people unwilling to engage and so on. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And now to lead on questions around COVID-19, Paul.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Yes, my questions are going to move us on slightly to talk about COVID-19. I think it's a far and wide-ranging impact. I think it's clear that every day we see the direct impact in terms of what the disease is doing in terms of hospitalisation and death, but I'm interested in those longer term effects in terms of, I think, both indirect health issues. I'm also particularly interested in long COVID and what impact we think that will have, particularly on people who already suffer poor health or live in areas of deprivation. So perhaps if we take the issue around long COVID first, I suppose I'm just keen to understand what impact. I mean, obviously we don't have a lot of data and information yet. It is something that's emerging. I think also in terms of interventions around that, there's still a long, long way to go. But I think really just to get a sense from the panel of the impact that will have, and indeed what interventions are required around it.
Okay, I'll go to Professor Smith first.
I think, I could say more about the impact that COVID's had on how we think about health inequality in public health than long COVID specifically, precisely because, as you've said in your question, the data on long COVID and our understanding of long COVID is really quite limited at the moment. There appears to be a gender dimension to it, an age group dimension, but I mean, the evidence is rapidly evolving in that area. And I think it's probably too soon to make a call about what the impacts are going to be of long COVID, but we do know that there does seem to be, as we would expect, and as there has been with COVID more broadly, an unequal impact of long COVID. So, I mean, generally, the way the COVID pandemic has played out is what my colleague Claire Bamber calls a syndemic, and it's interacted with health inequalities and societal inequalities that already existed. So those inequalities have made the impact of COVID more unequal and kind of worsened the impact. Then the impact of COVID is making inequalities worse, and it impacts obviously directly in terms of who has been most at risk of getting sick in the first place, then what if you get sick, who's most at risk of serious complications and illness. And then if we think about the wider implications of how that impacts on people's ability to work, to care for their families and so on, all of that has been unequal, which is exactly what, unfortunately, people working on health inequalities would have predicted at the start. And for me, what COVID has done in the context of health inequalities is draw attention to an issue that has been on the agenda for so long, but just hasn't had enough of a policy focus for us to really reduce health inequalities in the way that we would like. And on many of the factors that that explain why the impact of COVID-19 was so unequal are precisely the same kind of social determinants factors that we've talked about in the context of health inequalities for so long. You know, certain people are more vulnerable because they've already got higher burden of other kinds of illnesses, their immune systems aren't as effective, then they're exposed more, they're more likely to have had to go to work, they're more likely to be living in cramped housing conditions, have less access to a nice outdoor space, so then there's increased transmission. So all of those reasons explain the unequal impact of the pandemic, and of course we'd expect to see that in the impact of long COVID. I think what we can do about that now, I'd be wary about trying to be too ameliorative, and I think it really it kind of behoves us to think about that these more upstream social determinants approaches that have been on the agenda for so long, but which we just haven't quite managed to nail in Scotland in the way that I think we've got the potential to. Thank you.
And we'll go to Professor Burns.
Locus of control, if you feel pushed around by the circumstances outside you and not able to overcome them. And if you feel rubbish all the time, if you're tired, if you've got chronic headaches and so on, that just worsens your sense of control. And it will make people at the lower end of the social scale who have a poor sense of control and so on, it'll just make life worse for them. And it will do so in a way that's very difficult to detect. There's no test you can do to show that they have become more depressed and more isolated and so on because combination of inequality, poverty, and COVID has made difference. I mean, one of the most striking things has been the differential death rates in affluent and deprived individuals. And I would speculate, and I'd love to hear what Professor Marmot thinks about this, but I would speculate one of the reasons for that, there will be a reason in as much as people at the lower end of the social scale will already have a number of conditions that will make recovery difficult for them. But Professor Marmot many years ago described the fact that people at the lower end of the social scale have higher stress hormone levels than people at the higher end of the social scale. And one of the things that's been speculated in COVID is this cytokine storm, a rush of stress responses that have damaged the body. And that may well explain part of the difference. So COVID has worsened inequality and will continue to cause problems for people at the lower end of the social scale if they have continuing effects of having had the virus. Thank you.
And we'll come to Professor Marmot.
And what Catherine and Harry have both said so eloquently, I would agree with completely, that COVID has amplified the underlying inequalities, amplified them. Both COVID and the response to COVID, lockdown, has amplified them, which means that because we've controlled the pandemic so poorly, it's increased inequality. So let's take a step back. We know in the first half of 2020, the first phase of the pandemic, if you look at excess mortality, so not just COVID-19, but because there are differences in the way cause of death are assigned, look at the proportion, and look at the number of deaths you would have predicted in 2020 based on the previous 5 years. And then how many did occur, and the difference is the excess. The excess mortality in England was higher than in Scotland. In Scotland, it was higher than in Wales and Northern Ireland. And if you take the UK as a whole, the excess mortality was higher than in any other rich country. We look at the US in 2020 and said their management of the pandemic was a disaster. We were worse. We had higher excess mortality than the United States. The US can be proud their excess mortality is now higher than the UK's, but we're right up there. When I looked at the Johns Hopkins figures, I think yesterday, we're about 45 per 100,000 new cases daily. The US is about the same. We're about four times the rate of Germany, of France, of Italy. We've managed the pandemic appallingly badly. And in fact, I saw a correlation recently that if you look at what happened, if you look at what happened to life expectancy in the UK from 2010 to 2019, we had the slowest improvement of life expectancy of any rich country bar the United States and Iceland. But it was only the US that really did worse than us. If you look at the excess mortality during the pandemic and the improvement in healthy life expectancy in the decade before the pandemic, the worse the improvement in health before the pandemic, the higher the excess mortality during the pandemic. And I've speculated that in asking myself, what's the link? Why do countries that had a poor health record before the pandemic have a poor record of managing the pandemic? And I think the link potentially works at four levels. The first is the quality of governance and political culture. We really managed the pandemic very badly. You know, when Freedom Day was declared in July, we had 45,000 new cases that day. In Australia, when they had 1,000 cases, they locked down, complete lockdown. And 45,000 cases was fine for us to declare freedom. We really managed the pandemic very badly. So governance and political culture. The second is the increasing social and economic inequalities, the kinds of things that Catherine was referring to. The third was the disinvestment in public services over the previous decade. And the fourth was we weren't very healthy coming into the pandemic, which increases risk. So standing back, saying the pandemic increased inequalities, and part of the reason it increased inequalities was because we managed it so badly. And then, of course, when the management, for example, asking people to isolate, but not giving them the economic resources that made it possible for them to isolate. It turns out a study in Liverpool showed that one of the reasons people, poorer people, were not coming forward for testing for COVID was because they were scared that if they tested positive, they'd have to stop work and then they'd starve. So we didn't make the proper economic arrangements that helped us control the pandemic. That's quite apart from what Harry was speculating about, and I would agree with the speculation, that being lower in the social hierarchy puts you at higher risk of a whole range of disorders because of stress responses.
Thank you. Questions from David Torrance. David.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. With the pandemic causing huge backlogs within the NHS and pressure from politicians and especially the media, do you think primary prevention will be neglected?
I'll come to Professor Burns.
I'm not quite clear what you're asking. Primary prevention of other conditions?
Yes.
Yeah. I have no insight into that. I mean, I think primary prevention, if you're talking about the workload, the increased workload that the health service has been under, then clearly things like follow-ups to screening tests and so on in some places have been put on hold, and we're seeing the consequences of that. What I had been thinking should be done, there should be an audit. We should look very closely at what tests have been delayed, what interventions have been delayed, and so on, because there is a chance that things will get worse as we move into the winter. We're trying very hard. I think I get the sense that the NHS is trying very hard to recover. But if things get worse, as we might expect over the winter, then we might be back to square one again. And therefore, we need to try and understand where the delays are happening just now, why the delays are happening. You know, a lot of discussion this week about shortage of ambulance crews and so on. Are there specific bottlenecks in the process of moving people through the system that we should be tackling? And we're only going to know that if we collect the data. So I'm not sure if it's being audited at the moment. If it's not, it should be, and plans should be laid to cope with a worsening situation as we move into winter. I hope that doesn't happen. I hope the third immunisation approach to the over 55s will help that, but things always get worse for flu in winter, and therefore we need to start preparing for it now.
Okay, I'm very conscious of time. I'm going to bring in Gillian Mackay and then Sandesh Gulhani, and then we'll probably have to wrap up. Gillian.
So we've talked a bit about people's incomes, particularly during the pandemic, and with furlough due to come to an end, universal credit being cut, and incomes generally declining for those least able to afford it during the pandemic, Would the panel agree that a universal basic income approach could help to tackle some of the economic inequalities to poor health?
Okay, so I would like to brought in Professor Marmot at this point, but he's had to leave because he actually brought this up specifically. So if I come to Professor Burns and then Professor Smith on this.
I'm a fan of universal basic income. I think the evidence that we gather from studies in the US and Canada show that it does work. It does significantly improve health and well-being. I was told that America was, on the basis of its studies, was prepared to make universal basic income a civil right, but it was suggested that universal basic income led to an increase in the divorce rate in America at the time it was being tried. And folks said, well, this is what happens when you make women financially independent from their husbands, they divorce them. In fact, that was complete fabrication. The divorce rate did not go up, but things like infant mortality fell, engagement with schools increased, and so on. There are a number of very significant benefits from UBI, and I'm a supporter, and I don't understand why the trials that were being proposed never really came to anything.
Okay,
thanks.
Thank you. I don't know if Professor Smith wants to come in that. No?
I very much agree with what Harry said. All I'd say is there's lots of different designs for universal basic income, and you can set it at very different rates. And obviously, that has really big implications for how it functions in relation to inequalities. But I agree that it's a shame that the kind of proposed approach for trialling in Scotland don't seem to be progressing. It'd be really good to see that re-looked at.
Okay, we're actually coming up against the deadline for our session because we have a second panel, but I bring in Dr. Gilhani.
Thank you, Convener. Countries with the best funds, best working primary care seem to have better health outcomes with inequality. So with GPs being completely overwhelmed at the moment, do you think health inequalities and general health will decline?
Okay, I'll come to Professor Smith.
Well, I mean, I think unfortunately health inequalities are going to get worse in the context of the pandemic because of how we've seen the pandemic and health inequalities, societal inequalities interacting. In terms of GPs being overwhelmed, I mean, obviously that is a real concern, but I also feel that if we're thinking about the kind of longer term impacts of the pandemic on how people think about their health and well-being and in how they interact with the health service, I think there are some opportunities. This public health is much more in the public and media domain, much more in public and media conversations than it has previously. And that is an opportunity to facilitate better conversations and better interactions. So I think there's some, we could try and really build on that kind of wider public and media awareness of public health and of the importance of health services and interacting with them. And it'd be good to see Scotland do that. Thanks.
Okay, Professor Burns.
And giving them less time to unburden themselves and so on. You know, I've said several times in the course of this that, and the most important thing for someone who's struggling is the sense that they have someone who listens to them and they trust and value their time. And if GPs are not able to give people that time because they are so overwhelmed, then that will cause individual problems. I don't think there's any doubt about that. The best GPs that I know and speak to regularly are still trying very hard to give the people that they know are struggling that ear, that listening ear. So it's coming down to individuals who are going out their way in order to do the right thing for their patients. And I hope that, you know, and I believe that in Scotland, we have a very high quality of primary care available to the population in general. Thank you.
Thank you. Sadly, we're going to have to allow our first panel to go. There's so much in there. I want to thank everyone, Professor Burns, Professor Marmot and Professor Smith for their time this morning. We are going to take a very short break before our next panel comes in. Thank you.
Thank you.
Our fourth item today is a roundtable with stakeholders to discuss key themes and issues facing the NHS in Scotland. And this is intended to inform the committee's future work programme discussions. And I'll introduce all our panellists now. We welcome to Dr. Sue Robertson, the Deputy Chair of the British Medical Association Scottish Council, Donald Morrison, the General Dental Practitioner for the British Dental Association, Ross Barrow, Vice Convener of Allied Health Professions Federation Scotland, Graham Henderson, Executive Director of Delivery and Strategic Development for the Scottish Association for Mental Health, Kate Seymour, the Head of Advocacy for Macmillan, and Colin Pullman, the Director of the Royal College of Nursing. Now, with six panellists, just a little bit of housekeeping, I've asked members to direct their questions to individuals specifically. If any of the panellists want to come in and add to anything, if you could use the chat function and put an R in the chat box, and the clerks will relay that back to me, and I'll try and bring you in as much as possible, rather than everyone answering the same question, because we really don't have the time to do that, sadly. I was wanting to open things up, and this is the one exception to that housekeeping rule that I've just said, because I would like to go around to everybody, first off, to ask what you want to see prioritised by the Scottish Government within the health social care portfolio, and of course not just the Cabinet Secretary but the health ministers in the next 5 years. And if I can just go to Dr. Robertson first of all.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for having us. What do we do for the next 5 years? Well, I think we need to address the vacancy rates in the NHS in Scotland. We need to address the fact the workforce is exhausted, the vacancy rates are high, demand has gone through the roof, and that with the public messaging of the Scottish Government's NHS recovery plan that's stating that we can increase capacity by to 110%, but without any realistic plans to increase the workforce in the short term, gives us, we think, a perfect storm. We want to engage to try and find solutions. I was struck by Professor Burns in the previous session saying, and I'll quote him, "You can create wellbeing by creating an environment where people feel safe and supported, and that hopelessness and helplessness creates ill health." And I think you have staff within the NHS in Scotland who feel hopeless and helpless, who are keen to engage but with whom nobody is engaging. And there is abundant evidence that workforce stress in healthcare organisations affects quality of care for patients and staff health. So to prioritise some staff health and wellbeing will retain the staff that you have and make this place a better place to work.
Thank you, and apologies to Dr. Zamfar. I stupidly didn't read the end of my list of people, and I didn't include you in the list. So I'm actually going to come to you now, Dr. Zamfar, for your asks of the Scottish Government in terms of prioritisation.
Hello.
Yes, we can hear you perfectly.
Yes. So, first of all, thank you for inviting me to this meeting. I am here as the chair of BAPIO, the British Association of Physicians of Indian Origin. I have seen the five-year plan, and there are a few things I would like to mention. About a third, I mean, these are issues that particularly affect the Black and Asian minority ethnic doctors. And I'm here basically to raise the issues that affect this group of medical professionals. So about...
We appear to have frozen in broadcasting. Yeah, we'll hopefully come back to Dr. Zamfar once we connection is re-established. Can I come to Donald Morrison?
Hi, thank you, panel, for letting me speak today. I'm just, for context, I'm a general dental practitioner, a high street dentist, for nearly 25 years, and I've worked in England for 10 years in the NHS system there. In the last 14 years, I worked in Scotland, and I currently run and work in a practice that's in Ayrshire. It's a mixed dental practice, and we're responsible for nearly 6,000 registered NHS patients. I'm speaking today on behalf of the BDA Scotland, and just for the record, I'm feeling really nervous. I've not done much of this before, so I'll try not to make a fool of myself. What we would like, I believe, the main thing about the profession, I suspect, is going to sound like a broken record. Prior to pandemic, it was acknowledged by Scottish Government that the NHS system that the dentists were working under was broken or was not fit for purpose. And we were in conversations to try to find a funding model and find a sustainable forward-moving plan for dentistry. That seems to have been completely dropped. We feel probably that the worst possible thing that's happened is there's very, very little communication or meaningful, timely communication between the profession and the Scottish Government. And we would beg the panel to have a look closely at this for us over the next 5 years, that we could be discussing the needs of our patients and the needs of dentistry in a way that allows us to move forwards and come out of the sort of dark ages of dentistry, which it feels a lot like now. Dentists will often talk about treadmill and working cheap item and piecemeal, and at the moment we're in a situation where it was bad before, and COVID is really shining a light on that now. It feels particularly dark and difficult just now. And so we would really want, obviously, funding looked at, engagement looked at, but the most important thing is that we want Scottish Government to engage meaningfully with the profession and discuss it with us, so that we can help develop how to look after our patients properly.
Thank you. And can I come to Ross Barrow?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for inviting me along today. I'm here on behalf of the Allied Health Professions Federation for Scotland, and we're a multi-professional grouping of 12 professional bodies representing AHPs across Scotland. Just for a bit of context, AHPs make up the third largest workforce in NHS Scotland, and employing 14,000 staff headcount across a range of settings, including acute care, primary and community care, and social care. This is a really critical moment for all our professions and everyone represented here today. And I suppose as we look to recover from the pandemic, what we would hope for as an HPFS is that it could be recognised that AHPs have a lot to offer in this current agenda by using their unique skills and training to treat people in all of those settings that I've just outlined. And that critically includes treating people closer to home in primary and community care, in order to kind of focus on supporting people in their own community and reducing the burden, which was already significant pre the pandemic, which is certainly even more significant now, on things like acute and waiting times for surgery, where we think that allied health professionals are able to offer solutions in the community. If we could ask for really one thing, I think it's already been mentioned before, and it's probably no surprise, is that the workforce is a key issue that affects all our professions. It affects us all in slightly different ways, as we're all a multi-professional grouping. But effectively, whether it's the fact that there's not enough posts for AHPs in particular settings, or whether there's a very high number of vacancies, and maybe we'll get a chance to talk about that in today's session, we really need to have integrated allied health professional workforce planning, which is something that's really not on the agenda, or hasn't really happened in the way that we would like to. So as an HPFS, we would be delighted to be part of that solution in terms of offering what we can to kind of alleviate some of the workforce challenges across Scotland.
Okay, and we're going to be looking in depth on some of those issues that have been outlined in terms of workforce and workforce planning. Dr. Zamfar is back, so I'm going to come to him to finish off what he was saying before he was thrown out of the meeting, Dr. Sanfar. If we can have his microphone unmuted, please.
Hello.
Hi, we can hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm sorry, I lost the connection last time. I kept on talking and I don't know where I lost the connection.
We've really only got a sentence in, so if you maybe just want to start from the beginning, that would be fine.
Okay, so if you're planning for the next 5 years, what we would like, now I represent the BAPIO, which is the British Association of Physicians of Indian Origin. What we would like is we would like race equality and race relations to move up the agenda in NHS in Scotland. About a third of the medical workforce in Scotland are either international medical graduates or BME doctors, Black, Asian and minority ethnic doctors. And a significant proportion of this major part of the workforce feel that they do not have a level playing field as far as career progression in the NHS is concerned. And this differential attainment starts early off during examinations in medical colleges, during postgraduate examinations, and throughout their career as doctors and consultants in the NHS. There's a lot of data from England, but published data from Scottish government is missing, or there's very limited data from Scotland. There was the recent report called the Medical Workforce Race Equality Standard Report, which was published from England, and it looks at the different issues affecting the differential attainment, basically, affecting doctors in the NHS and in the academic part of portions of the NHS. And I would suggest to the Scottish government that there should be a similar report from Scotland as well, because this brings out the great disadvantage that BME doctors face. And it's not only in their employment, it's also the regulator, the General Medical Council, referrals to the GMC by the employers, by NHS employers, is twice as much in the for BAME doctors compared to their white counterparts. And also the GMC processes and outcomes are harsher or appear harsher for the BME doctors. There are many anecdotes, and I don't think this is from Scottish hospitals as well, but this is not the time and place to mention them. But in the next 5 years, as we come out of COVID and as we press the reset button, race equality should come up the agenda. And also, as we catch up with the COVID backlogs, a lot of extra work will need to be done. And we would like to see the staff grade and associate specialist doctors also playing a very important role in this, not just the consultants. And I think I'll stop over there.
Thank you. And can I come to Graeme Henderson?
Yeah, good morning. Sorry, I was unmuting myself here, getting that you guys were in control of that. So good morning, everyone. Three things, I think, from our manifesto, which we shared with probably most members of the committee ahead of the elections. And then I'm going to come to a fourth thing around social care reform. So the first thing we would be calling for would be that children get help when they ask for it. We've still got upwards of 7,000 young people being rejected from CAMHS referrals. And I know that the government doesn't like the term rejected referrals, but we will continue to use that term until such times as there's been a change in the system that prevents people being missing out on services. We'd also like to see an increase in psychological wellbeing support, so talking therapies. Still people waiting for months when they've been referred for psychological support, and we want a more accessible service so that people don't have to go on waiting lists. We'd also like to see more communities supported to prevent suicide, and we've been supportive of the government's Suicide Prevention Action Plan and the work of the National Suicide Prevention Leadership Group, and we'll continue to support that group and work with it. In terms of social care reform, the Peeling report has made many recommendations, and we are very supportive of that report. Just in terms of Dr. Robertson and Mr. Barrow made the point about the workforce. The social care workforce is under great strain at the moment. We've got high vacancies, we've got high turnover, high burnout. We've got people who are off long-term sick with long COVID, and we're really struggling to help our colleagues in the NHS and the local authorities to move people out of hospital. An example would be just the other week there, we were speaking to Glasgow City about 34 people who are in inpatient psychiatric beds who are delayed discharge, so there's no social care for them to leave hospital. And that has a knock-on effect inside the whole system. So we'd like to see the social care reform actually being a reform and not just tinkering around the edges. Thank you.
Thank you. And can I come to Kate Seymour?
Good morning, everyone, and thank you for the invitation. I think from a cancer perspective, we have the immediate challenge caused by the pandemic of the disruption to diagnosis and some treatment and the backlog that needs to be cleared as urgently as possible, and that we have, we believe, up thousands of people who haven't come into the system when we would have expected them to, and as those people come through, they'll have more complex needs and sadly are likely to be diagnosed later. So that's a huge challenge. But looking to the 5 years as well, we would really like to see an effective delivery of personalised care. So that's looking at the full needs of the individual in terms of their emotional and psychological needs, their financial needs, practical. Because if we can do that well, then that has a really positive impact, not just on the individual, but also in reducing pressures on the system. And it also will help to reduce inequalities, which is a big issue for us in Scotland in terms of health inequalities. We have a programme we're very proud of with the Scottish Government, Transforming Cancer Care, which is looking to do that in a different way, working with local authorities and with the NHS. I think we need that radical approach to looking at workforce. We recently published a Cancer Nursing on the Line report, which was looking at the challenges for specialist cancer nursing in Scotland. But we also need to look at it from the point of that whole skills mix and the opportunities that the integration of health and social care in our system gives us in terms of how we can make sure that all the different aspects of the workforce that the other contributors have talked about all work together and are really integrated in terms of planning and delivery.
Thank you. And Colin Pullman.
Good morning. Thank you for the opportunity to come before the committee today. I follow colleagues, and our members are telling us at the moment that they've never been under greater pressure than in their careers that they've experienced through COVID. But obviously, we know that COVID has highlighted what is long-standing problems in health and social care. That's including workforce planning has not been up to what we require it to be. You know, being able to guarantee safe staffing levels, we've not been able to do that. And there's the elements of pay and reward, which I think are really important, as well as the support that we need to put in place or continue to put in place for staff. Workforce pressures are key that we believe that you require to look at over the 5 years, and that covers a huge number of aspects. But if we don't have the correct workforce in the correct place, we can't deliver what we need to require for the needs of the population. Workforce planning in the past has been financially driven generally, and it needs to be driven by the needs of the population. We are at a, colleagues have mentioned, we're at a critical time, and I do think that we can look and learn from the past and not make some of the assumptions that we've made that have landed us in the place that we are. Recruitment and retention, we mention in the same breath. I think we need to split that and we need to talk about a recruitment strategy that covers us for the medium to long term. And we also need to look at retention, and we need to look at a retention strategy that's going to be sustainable and allow us to get through what we're going through now and moving on from COVID. And when we talk about recovery, we might have to have much more detailed plans and considerations. And I was very struck from colleagues in the previous session around about talking about listening to the clinicians at the front line. Speaking on behalf of the RCN, you'll have no surprises. I absolutely support that, because if we do not engage with our clinicians to come forward with the solutions, we won't get to where we need to be. Thank you.
Thank you. And that's really helpful to hear from you all on the sort of like general priorities. I'm going to pass on to my colleague Paul O'Kane, who will direct his questions, and if anyone wants to come in off the back of it, please use the chat function and put an R and I'll come to you. Paul.
Thank you, convener, and thank you to panellists for that very helpful introduction. And I think we've touched on a number of key themes there, particularly around the pressures being experienced in our NHS, and I think the real pressure that is on staff and the real challenges I think we're having in terms of staffing. I think I'm keen to get a sense around the recovery plan that's been published by government. I know that there's already been a variety of responses to the publication of this plan. For example, Dr. Lewis Morrison from the BMA saying that it's only a start at best, and also hearing other things out of the RCN around, I think, the pressure on staff. So I think the point that was just made around, does it do enough, essentially, to address staff burnout and stress. So I think I would be keen to perhaps hear from Dr. Sue Robertson around this. Just what confidence do you have that the recovery plan is actually going to deliver the transformation that is going to be required?
Thank you. I mentioned the recovery plan and the public messaging around that, that the Scottish Government have told the public that we can increase capacity to 110%. But as far as we can see, there isn't anything realistic to deliver that, to increase the workforce in the short term. We talk about new treatment centres, but new treatment centres need new staff. We can't just move the deck chairs. You can't just take the staff from one place and put them in another place, because then you have no staff in the first place. We don't have enough medical staff, and we don't have enough nursing staff. We don't have enough AHPs. We don't have enough social care staff. Without that being addressed in the short and medium term, you can't deliver even what we're trying to deliver now, never mind increased capacity. And the public messaging makes it harder to be a frontline member of staff. A recent Dignity of Work survey, and that's even before the pandemic, a third of doctors were suffering emotional verbal abuse from members of the public. And that comes from the public not being told what's really happening and what they could really expect from the service. The people within the service are all working to their maximum and possibly past their maximum capacity. And they're tired, they're exhausted. They feel they have little control over their work environment, and often the culture within which they're working is not ideal. I would suggest to panel members that they might consider reading the GMSD publication from November 2019, Caring for Doctors, Caring for Patients. And I think you could put caring for healthcare and social care staff in that, but it does, the GMC obviously looks at doctors. 8 key recommendations, if you only read the 8 key recommendations, they're all based around 3 themes: autonomy and control, belonging and competence. So ABC, so that's having a voice, having work conditions that are appropriate for you, being able to work as a team, having the culture that allows you to feel your voice is valued, managing workload, and being allowed to learn, train and develop, being allowed to be part of the solutions and working together as a team to do that. You can't do any of that without have enough staff on the ground to do it. And so longer term, yes, this plan talks about recruiting from overseas. That's a long-term thing. The most important thing we can do now is retain the valuable staff that we have in place, give them a place that's better to work within and a system that's better to work within, and then you will recruit easily. If you retain your present staff, your short-term and medium-term, you're able to deliver the service that we have now. I'm not sure that we can deliver any more than we're doing at present, and that obviously needs to be addressed. But if you can retain your short and medium-term staff, then recruitment will be much easier because this will be a better place to work. So again, it goes all the way back to the Sturrock report, for example, 2019, looking at workplace culture, proper workforce planning. You know, there's still a lack of clarity over the plans for GP recruitment. We were told 800 more GPs by 2027, but we have no clarity on how that is to happen. We still don't know what the plan is. And if we don't know what the plan is, I'm not sure anybody knows what the plan is, but I'd love to know if somebody else on this round table is aware. So it's not just sound bites. We need action. We need consideration of culture. We need to retain the workforce that are here, and we need to involve them in finding solutions.
Paul?
Thank you. I think that is really key, and I think retention has been identified across the board as being so important, and I think it is about culture in terms of how do you encourage people to stay within the professions. But I wondered if the Royal College of Nursing wanted to add anything perhaps at this stage, just in, particularly in terms of those comments about burnout within the nursing profession.
Colin Pillman. Just wait for broadcasting to unmute you. Thank you.
Speaking to oneself, never good. In respect of following up from Dr. Robertson, she's absolutely right. At the moment, we need to really look at what we need to do to retain staff, and we need to allow staff time to rest and recuperate. They've been through a horrendous time, and we're already working in a pressured service. I know this might seem basic, but we do need to get back to basics for the staff. We need to look at what safe staffing levels, even simple things like ensuring people have rest breaks, they're working their contracted hours, and offering them a good work-life balance, as well as the support systems that we need to put in place. Now, we are improving the support systems, I have to recognise that, but we need to do more. And it does come back to looking at what we can do from, as I say, a retention plan that is sustainable. We talk about recruitment and retention in one breath and we pass it over, and I think they're two completely different things. And I think we need to look at specifically how do we do that and keep people in the workforce. I mean, the nursing workforce at the moment has nearly 5,000 vacancies, huge. And how do we actually keep the people who may be looking at potential flexible retirement and retaining them within the service? These are things that I think we do need to look at. And I'm a professional organisation. I come from a professional organisation in trade union, and you would be surprised to know that I think pay is a major element that we also need to look at. All healthcare workers have not kept up with inflation over the last 10 years, and these are things that we need to look at. And I agree with Dr. Robertson. We need to work at making the NHS and social care in Scotland a place that people want to not only come to work in, but want to stay to work in.
And Graham Henderson would like to come in.
Thank you, Convener. Just following on from the points made about workforce, the social care workforce, I've been in social care for just over 30 years. I'm a registered nurse, I came from the NHS. And when I joined the social care, it was Sam H, we had parity of conditions with the NHS or local authority, and our salaries were all tied to typically the local authority bandings. over the years, the last 30 years, that's been eroded. Competition has been allowed to just run like wildfire through the social care sector, and we're now mostly paying people on the Scottish living wage, and we can't compete, and we often lose people to go into social work or back to education or into nursing. We have very few nurses that work in SAMH. We've got about 600 staff, and when I joined, we had many nurses who were on equal pay to their colleagues in the NHS. And while we're not in it for money, when you've had your salary conditions eroded over time, then it becomes difficult to feel valued as an equal partner when you're doing the same work. And it's really important that individuals in the social care world are given equal value to their colleagues. And because I think Sue and Ross had made the points earlier about we're all in it together. We're all interdependent, so we all have to work together. And I think that's a really important point about valuing the social care workforce. Thank you.
Thank you. And Ross Barrow would like to come in. If we can just have the microphone unmuted. Broadcasting can just unmute Ross Barlow's microphone. Thank you. Oops.
Yeah, I just want to come in on the mobilisation recovery plan, and I just wanted to totally agree with what other panellists have said around. I think there's of course we need a mobilisation recovery plan. No one would deny that, but there is an element, sadly, of putting the cart before the horse when it comes to this. And actually, there's, you know, what we actually need is a workforce plan, which is what everyone has kind of commented on. I think the challenge around the mobilisation recovery plan is really around the mismatch between patient expectation and the reality of what's happening on the ground. And I hope you don't mind if I just run through some of the examples of that, in terms of, I'm sure we're fairly familiar with them, but just to highlight, you know, there's people who've gone without treatment during the pandemic because their need was not classified as high risk. There's people who've developed complications during the pandemic as a result of, for example, shielding or not being able to get out and about. And then there's people who are experiencing long COVID, you know, and they're suffering with the challenges of that. And actually, a mobilisation and recovery plan is great, but at the heart of that has to be a workforce plan, not only for HPs, but for all the professions and all the services that are represented around the table, and identifying where are you going to get the right person in the right place at the right time to tackle each of those three challenges. So, yeah, mobilisation recovery plan is great, but it needs to be fully integrated into understanding where the workforce pressures and needs are. And I think from an HPFS perspective, that's where we would like to start. Thanks.
Thank you. And I'll come to Dr. Sandesh Gohani, who's got some questions on this. And if you can direct your questions, that would be great.
Thank you, convener. We heard from Sue Robson, actually, the whole panel, about the difficulty we have in staffing. Adding race equality or inequality on top of this makes life for BAME staff worse. So my question is, what can we do to improve race equality in our NHS? And I'd like to start with Dr. Zamba.
I think we should talk about it. We should acknowledge that there is a problem, or at least acknowledge that there is a perception of a problem, and that would be the first step. I don't know how many of you have seen the Medical Workforce Race Equality Standard Report, which came from NHS England just last month. It is the first time, I mean, there is a race equality report for all NHS staff, but this report focuses on the medical workforce, and it has really brought out the stark inequalities that between that BAME doctors face. And I think we should, as a first step, do something similar in Scotland as well. That would go a long way. At least we will know what the problem is so that we can start addressing it. And the second thing I would like to suggest is to look at why from the employers, from the NHS employers, it's more often the BAME doctors that get referred to the GMC, and is there anything that can be done to solve the problem at a trust level rather than it having to go to the GMC, the regulator. So those are some of my suggestions that will help address this problem.
Okay. I'm going to move the conversation on to around COVID-19 and the backlogs, unless you wanted to come to anyone else. Emma Harper, could you lead on this, and I'll bring in other members as we go.
Okay, thanks, convener. We've heard over the last few weeks since the recovery plan was published that there's obviously going to be a need to address backlogs of like cancer diagnosis, breast cancer, bowel cancer, cervical smear test. There's going to be issues of addressing ophthalmic surgery, so cataracts, hip and knee replacements, all of that. So I'm wondering how we're going to address that demand, because we have, during the pandemic, basically stopped the elective approaches, and even now we're seeing the ICUs filled with COVID patients rather than the elective bowel surgery patients, for instance. So where do you see the need to tackle this backlog of surgery requirements, for instance, and diagnostic testing?
And who would you like to address that to first?
Maybe Dr. Sue Robertson, please. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. It's a massive problem. We were under great strain before, and we have changed the way that we do everything, at least temporarily, and some of those changes will remain. The backlog of people waiting for elective surgery is huge. For example, in my own region, I was told last week it's probably going to be about 70 weeks before somebody who needs a hip replacement clinically needs that, because probably they're being woken up by pain every night and are on maximum doses of painkillers. Before that person gets a hip, it's probably going to be 70 weeks. That's a long, long time. And that then also increases the morbidity that they will suffer from their painkillers, for example, and from their lack of mobility. So during that 70 weeks, they will probably feel quite hopeless. They will probably have to go on more and more painkillers, which may have adverse effects on their health. They will get less and less active, and that again will impact adversely on their health. And it will mean that they may well sort of go rolling down the hill before they get their hip replacement, and then have to climb that hill of health again. So this is a massive problem, but we don't have the facility and the staff to increase that, to meet that demand, because we only have the staff to do what we were doing anyway, and everybody was working to a maximum. So without retaining the staff, without increasing your staff numbers, and that's not just doctors, that's all of us that deal with patients in these positions who are waiting what we call elective surgery, but for them is probably something they feel is very urgent because they're in pain. So without the extra staff and without retaining the staff and stopping people feeling like they need to retire because they can't do their job in this place any longer because it's adverse effects on their health and their family, then we can't then deliver that increased capacity that we need. So it's not a simple, well, let's just build treatment centres and do all the elective surgery there. As I said before, this is a very complex, very difficult problem. And it may mean that we have to stop doing some of the things that we do at the moment if we are going to try and address the backlog. And that requires a societal discussion and honesty and honest public messaging about what we can do, not what we might wish to do, but what we can actually do and what we can actually deliver over the next 5 years. And I think that honesty with the public is absolutely key at this point. And honesty with the public allows them to be part of the debate, but also protects the frontline healthcare staff who are being abused often by members of the public because they don't understand why we're not doing what they feel we should be doing. And it's because we're just all working to our maximum.
I'm going to bring in Kate Seymour.
Thank you. Just to build on what Sue was saying, I think the pressures will be on all parts of the system. So if you think about someone who comes into the system late because of the pandemic, they've been diagnosed, their cancer's being diagnosed late, they're much more likely to be diagnosed through A&E, so the increased pressures on the emergency part of the system. Their needs will be more complex. They may need more input from AHPs or the other professions, and the impacts on palliative and end-of-life care, because more people will be coming in diagnosed at a later stage, will increase as well. So we have to think of this from a whole system perspective in terms of the pressures it puts everywhere, and that need for additional resource everywhere to make the system work well. And just to come back to that, the importance of that integrated thinking and integrated workforce planning to make sure that we can reduce pressures where we can, to make sure that people's needs are dealt with by the most appropriate part of the system right across health and social care. I know that's a huge challenge, the most obvious example when we talk about bed blocking, but that's the kind of thing we have to do better if we're even going to be able to begin to address the resource challenges that we face.
And Donald Morrison would like to come in.
I think it's probably repeating what's been said, but one of the most important things for us as for health professionals is that oral cancer is one of those cancers that is picked up really asymptomatically, and it's one of those things that regularly screened and picked up. Scotland has one of the highest oral cancer rates in Europe, and the treatment is in early stages is relatively simple, but the sequelae of it is horrible disfigurement and really quite drastic, difficult surgery. So I think the imbalance between the two things is just such a big, big, major part of of screening the patients and seeing these patients on a regular basis, which we just can't physically do just now. And you're twice as likely to die of oral cancer in Scotland if you're from a deprived community. And that's only going to just increase this, the inequalities gap will grow larger and larger. And we're only at the tip of the iceberg on this. This is going to, in the next 18 to 24 months, is really going to come home to roost. So I'd be very, very concerned about the fact that because of the way the screening works, we're not even feeding these people into the system yet because we don't get to see them.
Could I just clarify, is that something that you're picking up signs of oral cancer when you're doing more routine work in the checkups and the other types of like dentistry, and that's when you're spotting it early?
Not only spotting it early, but it's asymptomatic. People don't feel it when we find it. Often you'll get someone presenting with something that they'll say, this is a bit sore, I've noticed it, can you do something about it? But often you look in the mouth as a routine and you see a lesion and you say to the patient, how long have you had that? And they say, well, I haven't even felt it. I didn't even know it was there. And you say, well, let's have a look at it in a couple of weeks' time. It's unresolved. It's then put into the system. All surgeons will see it. They'll biopsy it and find its cancer and remove it in the space of 6 to 8 weeks. If left to go untreated, the patient doesn't always feel very, very uncomfortable, but by the time it's spread on, it's a radical neck dissection. It's just the patient will be deformed by the surgery. It's major chemo. All these things go into treating someone with head and neck cancer. And yet when we pick up these things as a screening process, when we look at a patient every 6 months, detect it and it's treated very early. And all of that, well, not all of it, because we, every time now that the dentists now, every time we get a patient in front of us, for whatever reason, we do that screening now and we try to keep that going. But there were 4 million attendances lost last year through COVID. You know, we lost so much. So that, yes, it can be just detected through general, just looking in the mouth.
Okay. Thank you. I'm going to come back to Emma, but I just wanted to pick up on something that Dr. Robertson said around what patients can expect. And I guess it's a difficult line because on the one hand, during like lockdown periods of people who maybe really should have engaged with their health professionals and didn't because they were worried that they were like adding to the stress. But now, certainly, I think we're all seeing in our inboxes that we're perhaps having the public maybe expecting more than the services can give. How do we strike that balance? How do we manage patient expectation?
I think we have to have honest conversations with the public. I think at the moment, we are almost in a place where if you shout loudest, then you get what you want. And as somebody who, as I say in the chat, works on an admissions unit, you see patients who haven't wanted to bother anyone because they know we're really busy. But you see them further down the line of their illness trajectory than they would have been otherwise, when they perhaps need much more powerful drugs or much more major surgery than they might have done otherwise. So it's having that conversation with the public about what we can deliver, about the fact that if you shout loudest, you won't necessarily be the one that gets the care. The care has to be delivered on clinical priorities, not on who complains loudest. And if we are to be the society that I think we want to be, which is a caring, equitable society, we have to have that societal conversation, I think.
And can I just... I just wanted to ask what the place is in that honest conversation for the media and politicians in that, because that can perhaps exacerbate some of the problems if it's not done carefully. What are your thoughts on the role that maybe we as politicians need to play in that, and by extension the media, because that's where a lot of the messaging lies?
I think at the moment it feels like we're almost working against the politicians and the media. It feels like we are trying our best to deliver the best care we can. And then, for example, the NHS recovery plan, the big headline is we're going to increase the service by to 110%. I think that what we would ask is that politicians engage with us and the others around the screen, and we work out how best message the public, and we take this away from vote winning, vote losing decisions, and we take it to this is the best for our society and for the individuals within that society. And I think it has to be taken as that. It has to be taken as something which is a very long-term societal conversation about what can be delivered, what people are demanding, and where those match and where those have a mismatch, and then how do we address the mismatch perhaps in other ways.
Thank you, that's very helpful. I'm going to come back for a quick supplementary question from Emma before moving on to talking about staffing more generally.
Okay, Emma. Thanks very much. I will try and be quick. Social prescribing is something that we did a report on in the last session of Parliament, and obviously keeping people out of hospital in the first place can be done by engaging in practices to support health and wellbeing, to support physical, physical activity, so preventing complications of type 2 diabetes. 10% of the NHS budget is spent on mitigating complications of type 2. So I'm just interested in what the panel would think, or and I suppose Gillian, convener, can choose somebody to answer the question.
But it'd be good if you could, Emma.
Where do we, I suppose, what value do we need to place on social prescribing to stop folk getting poor health in the first place, support pulmonary rehab, support type 2, mitigation of complications, things like that? Maybe I'll ask Dr. Robertson again, please.
Okay, thank you. I think we probably need to take a step even further back. I listened in to the first session, and I listened to Harry Burns talking about poverty and health, helplessness and hopelessness. We need to look at the health of the population and try and improve that in any way that we can. And that's giving people opportunity, giving people support, making people feel like a valued member of society. We also need to increase, and you know I would say this, Emma, because I'm a big physical activity person, increase the possibilities and the encouragement for people to be more active and to live healthier lives. But they need to have the opportunity to do that. So you need to look, as Sir Michael Marmot said, you need to look at every policy and how it impacts on health. So looking at the built environment, building schools in places that children can walk and cycle to, so that walking and cycling becomes the norm. And when the children walk and cycle, then the parents walk and cycle and they become healthier. You reduce your risk of type 2 diabetes, you improve your lung health, you improve your general health, and you reduce your risk of other diseases. So it's looking at health in all policies. And I think only by doing that can you actually shift this big oil tanker that is our unhealthy population and shift them round, and then make them, the next time another COVID comes around, more resilient and more healthy. And so they're less likely to become ill or to sadly die of some other illness that will attack the least healthy of our society.
And Graeme Henderson would like to come in. Graeme.
Thank you, Convener. I was going to talk to the, you know, a number of years ago, government funded the Alliance and SAMH to test out link workers in primary care services in Glasgow. And these link workers are social prescribers. They link people to things that are happening in their communities that they can do. A lot of them are physical activities, but there may be many other community things and activities that people could partake in that would benefit their health. Since that was that pilot, it was written up and there was lessons learned, there was training described, there was an approach described. And then it went out to local authorities. And in fact, I asked Public Health Scotland for information on this, because I'm aware, because of tendering processes, that we have a variety of different approaches to link working. So in some local authorities, we have banned seven nurses who carry a caseload. In other places, we have Scottish Living Wage third sector workers who don't carry a caseload. So there's a lack of consistency across Scotland in our approach to link working, which is really confusing for patients and the workers. Because, and I think it's been a real missed opportunity to not learn the lessons from the pilot and then implement it. Now, I'm not arguing against local democracy here, but perhaps the government could have been a bit more robust in its guidance to local authorities about link working based on the pilot and the study that was done some time ago.
Thank you. And Kate Seymour wants to come in on this.
So just a couple of things for me, just in response to Graeme there, that I would totally agree, Graeme, and that's why we set up a Transforming Cancer Care partnership with the government, which has that approach of link workers in local authorities, supporting people with all their needs around cancer. And obviously that is just for cancer, but that's what that model attempts to do. And just on the back of what Sue was saying, I completely agree on the need to improve the general health of our population. But equally, I think it's not too late once someone is in the system and has ill health. So once you've had a cancer diagnosis, we're doing a lot of work with prehabilitation and also looking at all those areas around supporting people with physical activity, with their financial needs. And of course, not just from that point of view, but also with their emotional and psychological well-being. Because if we can support people with that through their cancer journey, then the likelihood of them coming back into the system through an emergency admission or through, you know, just their health deteriorating through their cancer treatment, it becomes less likely. So although getting in early is absolutely key, it is never too late, and often when someone gets a major diagnosis such as cancer, it is a really good intervention point to look at social prescribing and other support areas to improve people's health through that, and then lessen the likelihood of them needing more support later.
Thank you. So we've got a number of members wanting to dig deeper into the staffing issues that you've all raised. And I'm going to go first to David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to panel members. You've talked about recruitment and vacancies in the NHS. In fact, I think it was Dr. Robertson that mentioned it would take years to recruit from abroad, and Brexit hasn't helped either. How do we encourage and make the NHS attractive for people to retrain and for school leavers to look at the NHS as a career path for them?
And is that directed to Dr. Robertson?
It's directed to Dr. Robertson, sorry. Come here.
Thank you. As I said, I think retaining your workforce is the first thing. If you can provide a place of work that makes people feel valued, supported, and included, then you will retain your workforce. So it's about workforce culture. It's also about the workload. And as I say, you know, improving the work environment for doctors, that GMC paper, ABC, give people autonomy and control. So some sort of influence on what happens around about you and how your service is delivered, a feeling of belonging, so improve team working, culture and leadership, and then provide C is competence. So provide an environment that allows them to manage their workload, to be managed appropriately and given appropriate supervision and ability to learn, train and develop. And on top of that, you have to pay people well enough for the job that they do. And that goes across not just doctors, but everyone. Many of our wages have gone down in real terms over the last 10 years. And you have what you want in the NHS and in social care. You want the brightest and the best. You want the people who really want to be there, who want to give a piece of their life force to each patient to help them get better. But you need to be able to give them a place to work that doesn't impact badly on their health, that doesn't leave them feeling, as evidence has suggested, that they don't have any energy left for their own family and their own loved ones because they are so burnt out by working in the environment that we do work in at the moment. So if you have people who want to stay in their job because the place of work is a place you want to work, you immediately have them telling school leavers that this is a great place to work. Come and work here. You will feel valued. You will be able to innovate and develop and be part of improving service and developing things as they go forward. You'll be financially valued, but you will also be personally valued. If you can provide workplaces that do that for people, that provide them with facilities for decent rest in their breaks, that look after them when they're tired and, you know, give them a place to lie down rather than drive home after a night shift if they're too tired, to save them having that crash on the way home, that leave people feeling that they still have some compassion left for their own families and their own loved ones and themselves, then school leavers will want to come and work there. You know, society will say, this is a great place to work. You know, you should want to come here. People within the job will not be saying, I can't do this any longer. I'm not at retirement age, but I need to find a way to get out of this and do something else. So the whole thing stands and falls on value. If people feel valued and people feel supported, then people will feel well. And Harry Burns said that you can create well-being by creating an environment where people feel safe and supported. And I would add value to that. You can do that with the NHS and social care, then you will have no problems with the staffing levels. And if you can be realistic with the public about what they can expect of those people that are trying their best at the moment, and about being gentle to those people who are trying their best at the moment, then again, you will make it a better place to be, and people will stay, and people will develop the service, they will make it better, and we will have a better place in Scotland.
So we've got other MSPs that want to come and ask questions. Just a reminder to all panellists, if you've got anything to contribute around the issues that are coming up here, please just put an R in the chat box and I'll get notice of it and I'll come to you. Gillian Mackay.
So following on from Dr. Robertson's contributions, I'm really interested in particularly staff morale and staff wellbeing. So are clinical and other staff getting enough support, and what can be done in the immediate short term to prevent a morale crisis, and what could be done long term to improve overall recruitment and retention in each of the groups that you represent? But I would like to probably start with Dr. Zamvar on that.
Thank you.
Hello, hi, thank you. I've just heard Sue Robertson answer the previous question. I think if we can create a workplace just like she described, that would go, miles in improving staff morale. Better financial rewards, but that's not the whole answer. There's a resource crunch as well. But making people feel valued, and at least be realistic with all the staff as well, what they can expect from the workplace.
I'll come to Graham Henderson now.
Yeah, thanks, Kavina. So echoing Sue's point about value, I think, is not just about financial value, but actually DATIS as a worker in a sector that's valued by the public and politicians. I'll give you an example of what we've done in the last 18 months is we've brought in an additional 2 days annual leave, and they're called wellbeing days. And they're specifically addressed to wellbeing because we value people's wellbeing. And they want people to take time for their own well-being, not just their holidays. And we've also given every individual staff member £100 well-being budget for them to use forever, whatever they want. Now, that obviously that costs money. So because SAMH has the capacity to do that, we can do that. But a lot of our third sector colleagues wouldn't be in a position to do that. So there's money that's to pay people, but also money that needs to be in the system to allow capacity for organisations to do things like I've just suggested.
Thank you. And Ross Barlow.
Thanks very much. Yeah, just on the question about improving morale, I just want to say that allied health professionals, as all health and social care professionals, really care passionately about the work that they do and about using their skills to provide the best care. So one of the ways that we can actually improve morale is by making sure that we've got the right healthcare professionals in the right place at the right time. So, for example, we were talking about backlogs previously. Allied health professionals all have the ability to assess, diagnose and treat, to work as first point of contact practitioners within primary and community care. If they are actually placed in the right places because there's enough workforce to support that overall package across the system, and they can see that actually for a patient, that means that instead of being on a waiting list for 12 to 18 months, it means that they're seen immediately by an allied health professional or someone else in primary community care, and they can get immediate access to treatment. That's going to be such a bonus and a morale lift, because actually they're able to do what they came into the profession to do. Just very, very quickly on staffing. I think Mr. Torch raised around kind of schools or how do we raise awareness of these kind of professions. There's a lot of work to be done by everyone and all stakeholders around raising awareness of allied health professionals and the range of things that you can do within your career as an allied health professional. But I also think there's a couple of things that we could do from a policy perspective to really improve the different routes into training, for example. So the introduction of degree apprenticeships for allied health professionals is something that's very important. We don't currently have that in Scotland, although it is available in other parts of the UK. And I think also we've got to look at bursaries for particular professions to incentivise people to come into professions that are maybe struggling to recruit over a longer term basis. And then finally, on return to practice, that is a really kind of important part of the jigsaw. And how can we incentivise people who have got really good skills? They might not be currently be working in health and care, but they've got really good skills and they could come back into that that system. And how can we support them with good quality CPD and training so they can really make the most of that and contribute? Thank you.
Thank you. Paul Kane has a question. I'm aware that other people from the panel want to come in, so I'm bringing in members to put some other things into the mix and you can pick up on the issues that have been raised so far. Paul.
Thank you, Convener. And I wouldn't disagree with much of what's been said, I think, in terms of that real pressure that's on staff. I suppose I'm interested in our immediate crises, if you like, and particularly the onset of winter, in terms of winter pressures across the piece. Obviously, we have a long-term planning in terms of workforce, but there is clearly an immediate need, particularly in acute settings, around how do we actually just physically keep the show on the road. And I think we're seeing a lot of that at the moment. And we're not even at kind of peak winter yet in terms of admissions and use of service. So I would be keen to understand what is it that's needed right now and what can be done right now to increase resource and staffing and what would make the most difference. I appreciate that's not an easy question to answer, but I'm really keen to just get a sense, possibly again from Dr. Sue or indeed
RCN,
or yeah. I could ask everyone, I suppose.
Yeah, I mean, if I come to Colin Pullman first, then I'll go to Dr. Robertson. Well, just hang on, your microphone is still muted, so give broadcasting a couple of seconds. There we go.
Thank you. I've been keen to come in. I mean, I can't agree with most that what's been said in relation to everything we need to do for environment, culture, support the staff, but morale clearly is under huge pressure at the moment. And your question, Mr. Torres, what do we need to do? Well, we need to work through what is an incredibly difficult time, and nobody has all the answers. And it comes back to this difficulty that we were talking around about this conversation we have to have with the public, because we have the unintended consequences of a longer wait and people wishing to be treated, but we then have the pressures of the system. We get that on a daily basis. We see it on the front of the media. And I think it's around about allowing our health and social care employers to work with our staff and to be honest what we can provide, and to work that through in a sustainable planning and be very clear when we can't do things, why we can't do them, because it comes back to this pressure that staff are reading in the papers of, you know, we've got to do X, we've got to do Y, when they know what the reality is. And I do think we need to actually come back to that reality to say, this is what we can provide now. This is why we've got these pressures. This will mean at times we need to reel back what we can do, because we need to use the resource that we've got, as well as looking in the short term at every avenue we can to try and bring people back into service who wish to be in service around retraining and support, and also looking at other ways of staffing so that we're not just putting increased pressures on the existing workforce, because the more we ask the existing workforce to do extra shifts to cover for whether it be increased sickness or whatever, the more pressure and more absence we will have, and that will add to more problems. And especially when we're going into winter, people feel it's winter now. That's what our members are telling us. It feels like it's winter right now in the middle of the summer. So we need to do all of these things, but it does come back to this really hard public message from the NHS, from social care, but also from the media and politicians around about honestly what we can provide currently, and that we are doing everything we can to move forward into the future, but it is going to be a difficult road.
And I'll come to Sue Robertson and then Donald Morrison after that. Dr. Robertson.
I absolutely in agreement with Colin on everything he said there. Public messaging is absolutely key, and that's the bit that we are not in control of. We are not in control of what the public are told. All we can do is try and deliver the best service we can. So that needs to be done centrally, and it needs to be done honestly, and it needs to engage the public within that as well. What else can be done right now? Social care. We need to pay people better in social care so that people are going to take those jobs, stay in those jobs. Not take a job as a carer and then find that you could earn twice as much stacking the shelves in Aldi. You know, we need to value social care for what it is. It is the bedrock of all of this. If we get social care right, then we can be a national health service that delivers what's needed. People can stay at home if they want to with appropriate care, or they can access appropriate care facilities if they need them. So if you get all of that right, then you take a massive amount of pressure off the NHS. And also, people are happier because people don't want to be in an acute hospital unless they absolutely need to be. And I think that's also a really key message. Better IT. You know, that's a constant bugbear for all of us, is that the IT we have to support the work that we do is glitchy, is not as good as it could be. We have lots of young people working within our service who have lots of really useful suggestions about how we can improve our IT in order to make the work that we do easier and quicker. And that's a huge one, you know, but it's actually asking people who are doing the job, how could we support you to do it better? What could we put in place? And for us, certainly increasing the number of nursing staff and AHP staff around about us, and also other members of staff to do jobs that we don't absolutely have to do, so that we can do the things that only we can do. And for example, the dietitian can do the dietitian's job, which allows me to be able to refer to a dietitian in my team and say, can you give me the nutritional requirements for this patient to keep them well while they're in hospital with this acute illness, so that they will be well when they go home, instead of going home having slipped a little bit down that hill. Physiotherapy, pharmacy, you know, all of these other parts of our healthcare team give us the ability to work as a team and give us the connectivity to work with primary and secondary care together as well. So all of those things could be addressed now. Culture within the organisations, absolutely, it's way past time. And I would signpost you to Dumfries and Galloway Health Board, and we are part of something called the Pro-Social Health Project, which is looking to improve the team working, personal well-being and culture within our organisation. And that's set up by our psychologists, but I myself am part of that group. We have operational development, learning, psychology, me from medicine, and our spiritual lead all working together to try and help teams improve the culture where they work, and to look at the way they work as teams and try and improve that. So there's lots of work that can be done. It does need people to be given the time to do it. And some of that work, you know, it's almost a spend to save. If you give people some time now, then it will absolutely save time in the future.
Okay, I'm going to come to Donald Morrison, and then we've got some members ask questions. I ask members to direct their questions to an individual you want an answer for, because we're rapidly running out of time, as I knew we would. Donald Morrison.
I'll try to be brief. I think as far as recruitment into the NHS regarding dentistry, one of the big problems we are having is through the hit of COVID, affected extremely heavily the university intake and the qualifying dentists coming through. So we essentially lost a cohort or were sent back to do another year's study. In addition to that, I mean, Sue mentioned Dumfries and Galloway. In Dumfries and Galloway, over 40% of the dentists are from outside the UK. So I don't know that how Brexit's going to affect us, but I suspect, although we haven't seen a drop-off of registrants, the general feeling from the practitioners is that anybody of retirement age will try to retire soon. Don't seem to have any immediate influx of dentists coming from outside the UK, and we've got a backlog of training. And the dentists coming up and into it are coming into a position where there's not really any funding in the classic term, in the sense dentists, high street dentists are not salaried. I think we've talked here about lots of things. There was and the patients are a priority. However, it's very important to point out that most of the dentists, 95% of the dentists, have a mix of NHS and private dentistry that they do, and the setup is geared against them working for the NHS. The funding has been reduced to 85% for them to continue to work, although they're at reduced activity. But the process that they have to put in place still means that to do a unit of work, a filling, you get the same money for it, and it takes you four or five times longer to do the same thing. And that just puts a stress on the workforce that means that they don't want to work in the NHS, or they can't make it financially viable for them to do it. And so you lose the situation where the dentist has the luxury of being able to take a lot of time and look after the patients and see as many as possible when they have to make a business that continues to be viable. And I think that sometimes the dentists tend to feel a bit like the Cinderella service, because that it really is, it is a small and medium business outside, as an annex onto the NHS. We work really, really hard for our patients and really hard to do all we can. But ultimately, the perfect storm of there not being enough sustainable future funding and a model that we can all work with and understand, then you'll lose dentists from NHS hand over fist in the future.
Okay, I'll come to a question from Sue Webber, and if you can direct it to somebody, that would be good.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, earlier on today we heard that all policy should be focused around healthcare, and we've also heard from some of the members of the panel that workforce planning should be coming first before we had that remobilisation plan. And we've also heard of the many diverse careers that are available to people in health and social care, including dentistry, so I'm not going to ignore that one. So I suppose this is for Sue, given that we've got a short time frame here. Maybe Sue Robertson can help us with this one. Do you think that the cap that we have on Scottish young people getting into our medical schools and universities across Scotland is negatively affecting our long-term recruitment and our ability to create that sustainable workforce plan?
This is a little bit more complex than just a yes or no answer, I'm afraid.
That's fine.
There is no doubt about it that we have many very able school pupils who would make very good doctors future and who want to do medicine. But we also have to have the ability to train them. And without the workforce to train those young developing doctors, then removing the cap and having more, we know that school pupils from Scotland are more likely to work in Scotland in the longer term. So absolutely, that's a tick. And we want more school pupils from Scotland to do medicine and stay with us. At the moment, if you increase the numbers of medical students in total, then there is going to be a significant risk that there are not enough of us doctors to train them and help them develop. And that's a significant risk. One of the main things I think we need to look at is the number of doctors that go elsewhere after the first 2 years of their practice. They do their foundation years in Scotland, and then some of the research would suggest around 40% of those young doctors go to other places in the world, because it is very, you know, Scottish medical training is very high quality and is respected around the world. And that's a good thing. But if we lose half of our young doctors to going elsewhere because potentially they look and they have experience of a healthcare structure that we're working within, and they don't like the culture and they don't like the way that doctors are treated, or the lack of ability to feel that their opinions are valued, then again, we're just going back into the same problem. It needs to be a workplace that they want to work in for them to stay. So absolutely, yes, I would like to see more young people in Scotland being able to do medicine, but only if there's enough doctors to train them appropriately, whilst also providing the healthcare that we need to as well. And then I would like to see a workplace that these young doctors would like to stay in. I do applaud the Scottish graduate entry medicine courses. I think they are increasing the number of young doctors who are born in Scotland and who often want to work with in general practice and psychiatry in areas that we definitely need more doctors. I absolutely support increasing the diversity of people who become doctors and looking at how we pick people for medical school and how to increase the availability of medical school places to people who have not perhaps had the best opportunities in life in school and so may not have quite as good a CV as someone who has had the best opportunities. So absolutely, we want more young people to do medicine, but we want them to be able to do medicine looking at working as doctors within NHS Scotland and looking at that as an attractive career and not wanting to train in Scotland and then leave because they see how burnt out their senior colleagues are when they experience their time on the wards or in general practice.
Can I bring in Stephanie Callaghan?
Thank you, Convener, and thanks everyone for your contributions today. I wanted to ask a little bit about the role of technology, so kind of coming at that from two different angles. Certainly I've had conversations as well where they've talked about, you know, we're not able to fill NHS, all the NHS vacancies at the moment, and we really need to do more things with less people. So really about the rapid adoption of technology and how that might help. The example, one of the examples I was given was radiology, where you've got AI diagnosis, but you've actually got the radiologists doing the more complex work. And then also looking at preventative care as well, the first one for Dr. Zamvar, and then looking at the preventative care aspect as well there, possibly Ross, looking at the idea of bed modelling and actually keeping people out of hospital, looking after them at home and getting them out of hospital more quickly when they are in there as well, and using technology and using advanced practices and more experience, helping colleagues maybe advance their career, take on more complex roles, and how we would do that. Thanks.
Yes. Question over to you.
Thank you. Thank you. I would definitely say we need better technology. I've lost Wi-Fi so many times this morning. About technology, for example, you mentioned AI, artificial intelligence, to look at radiology scans, etc. There is a lot of work happening, and this reports are coming mainly from US hospitals where they are using this technology, and it is possible to use this technology, and we should look at that. The only thing is, whenever you introduce new technology, it always costs more money. Though pilots may show it saves money, eventually it will take over and it will cost more. But this should not stop us from looking at this technology, because it will it saves time in the longer run, and it will save some misdiagnoses as well. So what was the next part about?
It was really about doing more with less people.
Doing more with less people, yes. I think we should be open to ideas. For example, in our department, I'm a cardiac surgeon. So we have nurse practitioners now doing ward rounds in our departments, and we also have surgical care practitioners assisting us at operations. So we don't really need an assistant surgeon to assist us at operations. So this has been happening for a number of years, but with the staff shortages with this COVID problem that we have had this year, moving forward, we should pay more attention to this and see what roles they can take so that we have more time to do other things.
And you wanted to bring...
Definitely in surgery, it is possible.
Thank you, Dr. Zamvar. I was going to bring in Ross Barrow to pick up on that later point as well.
Yeah, thanks. I think there's a number of issues with this. The first is really around how do you do more with less people? And this is around self-care management. So this is around working with patients and service users to really understand their own healthcare needs, and they feel an agent of change within that. So it's about seeing maybe the healthcare professional as an expert guide, but also allowing the patient or the service user to really be seen as a partner, so actually they are in control of a lot of the interventions. And you mentioned technology, and I know there's been talk of around an NHS app that people may be able to access either on a tablet or a mobile phone. And we think there's a massive opportunity there for two reasons. The first reason is that a lot of the self-care management advice, which may be kind of exercise videos, for example, or, you know, things to do when you come out of hospital after you've had an elective surgery, of course you need support from your healthcare professional with that, but there's actually a lot of information that you can give directly to someone on, you know, through the mobile phone or a tablet. That will not be the case for everyone. We have to really be careful about the population in Scotland who are digitally excluded, but for some people that might be a really good option for them as well.
Right, we are rapidly running out of time, but I do want to bring in Evelyn Tweed, who has got a very specific question to ask the panel.
Thanks, Convener. We've talked a lot today about the health and wellbeing of our healthcare staff and professionals, but what can we do immediately to offer them support, give them a listening ear, and make sure that they know that they are valued? What can we do immediately? A lot of the things that we've been talking about today are quite medium term, are quite long term, but what can we do now? Thank you.
And I guess we've got a number of people that we might want to address that as our sort of final question, so if you want to...
Yes. Dr. Robertson first, please.
Okay, what can we do now to listen to people? We can listen to them, for starters. We can still listen to them within their teams. Management and senior management can listen to and value the opinions of people working on the front line, working, you know, boots on the ground. I think that would be key. I think... you're listening to us, and that's excellent, and that makes me feel that our opinion is valued, and it's amazing how far that goes. I think we have now got gradually improving psychological services for staff, and I think that's absolutely key. We do need access to psychological services of all different levels for all staff involved in health and social care, and I think that's absolutely key, and I think that there's been a lot done within COVID that's shifted that forwards quite considerably. And I think that's really important. But simple things like having a space where patients and relatives can't go, where staff can go to take a proper break, means that you can have a break physically and mentally so that you feel stronger to go back to your shift. Having hot food within at night times, so that people who are working night shifts can actually access hot food in their break. Having somewhere that they can lie down and take their break, take the 20-minute power nap during the night shift that we know will improve their decision-making and reduce their compassion fatigue and make them a better team player. All of those things are things that could be done right now. And I think that, you know, that rest and facilities, psychological support and valuing people's opinions are all things that could be done right now. And I also think that I'm going to come back to this, the public messaging that people on the front line are doing their best. They haven't designed the service. So please don't abuse them when the service doesn't work for you. And support for staff who do have to face abuse, that you have a zero tolerance to that in the health service and in social care. These things can be done right now and will make staff feel supported and feel safer within the roles that they provide in this really, really difficult time. And as somebody else said, you know, we don't need to wait for winter to feel busier and more overwhelmed than we ever have in my 35 years as a doctor. It's now, and we're really worried about winter. And there will be a lot of staff who are just on the edge of their ability to cope. And it's not going to take much to tip us over. And so if you can put support in now and say, we value you enough to give you hot food at nighttime, we value you enough to give you a rest space that patients and relatives aren't there, those things just go a little way to make you feel that you're a valued member of a team, valued member of a big system, and that someone's got your back.
Thank you. Don Morrison and Graeme Henderson want to come in. I'm afraid that's all we've got time to take. If there was anything that other members of the panel wanted to say but didn't have time to, of course you can email us and you can let us know if there's anything you've missed. So I'm going to come to Donald Morrison.
Just on that note, I think I do appreciate, I don't want to be the one that's, I like to be as positive as possible, but asking what you can do, I think it's really important for our, certainly as far as dentistry is concerned, is what not to do just now. These things that do refer to this saying that can go 110%. In dentistry, they decided to wheel out free dentistry for 18 to 26-year-olds. We found out about that within 24 hours before. And I think that's a really simple thing to want, that that's not been discussed or certainly worked through with the profession, and the profession feels really like it's not being communicated with, and not doing things like saying it's business as usual, because it clearly isn't, and allowing at least our members to work under this very stressful situation without being told, without public messaging saying, go on, get on with it, it's business as normal, because it just isn't. And I think that one thing would be really, really helpful.
Okay, thank you. And finally, Graeme Henderson.
Thank you, convener. Just want to mention a service that SAMH developed and set up in the last year, which is a service called Time for You. And it's a three-tier psychological intervention for frontline workers. It was mainly directed at job workers and drivers and social care workers, but it's not exclusive. It's available to anyone. We've had just over 400 people register for the service. And we developed it in partnership with Glasgow Caledonian University, and we used their trainee psychologists to offer psychological interventions. So that doesn't cost a lot of money. It costs about £150,000 a year. And it offers, as I say, up to 4,000 people we can accommodate. And we used an online CBT-based approach called Living Life to the Full as part of the delivery. So that's a low cost, accessible service that I think has worked really well in the past year or so. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. And I want to thank everyone in the panel for their time this morning. I'm sorry we don't have more time to hear your views, but what you've told us has been very useful. So thank you very much. The fifth item on our agenda, excuse me, is consideration of a negative instrument, and that is the National Health Service, General Medical Services and Primary Medical Services Section 17C Agreement Scotland Amendment Regulations 2021. And the purpose of these new regulations is to fulfil a commitment to general practitioners to remove the general requirement to provide certain vaccinations from their GMS contracts and PMS agreements with health boards, and to ensure that GPs' contracts will only require GPs to provide vaccinations generally in exceptional circumstances. Now, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has considered the instrument has raised no issues with us, and no motions to annul have been received in relation to these instruments. So I would ask members if there are any comments, first of all, before I ask for a decision, if we have any disagreement on this. Does anyone get any points they would like to raise in relation to this instrument? No. So I propose that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree? No. Thank you very much, colleagues. At our next meeting on the 28th of September, the committee will host two roundtable sessions with key stakeholders to explore Session 6 priorities in relation to social care policy and health finance, respectively. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you.